song, wake the song, the song of Jubilee. Wake the song of joy and gladness, hither bring your noblest lays. Banish every thought of sadness, pouring forth your highest praise. Sing to him whose care has brought us once again with friends to meet, and whose loving voice has taught us all the way to Jesus' feet. With the song, of joy and gladness. With the song, of Jubilee. Joyfully with songs and banners, we will greet the festal day. Shout aloud the glad hosannas and a grateful homage pay. We will chant our Savior's glory while our thoughts we raise above, telling still the old, story, precious theme redeeming love. Wake the song, the song of joy and gladness. Wake the song, the song of Jubilee. Thanks to thee, O Holy Father, for the mercies of the year. May each heart as here we gather swell with gratitude sincere. Thanks to thee, O loving Savior, for redemption through thy blood. Breathe upon us, Holy Spirit, sweetly draw us near to God. With the song, the song of joy and gladness. With the song, the song of Jubilee. With the song, the song of joy and gladness. With the song, the song of Jubilee.
Amen. Oh well. Fourth hymn, song number 474, Take the Name of Jesus With You. Child of sorrow and of woe, it will joy and comfort give you. Take it then, where'er you go. Take the name of Jesus with you.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it, then where you go, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven, precious name, oh, how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Take the name of Jesus ever as a shield from every snare. If temptations round you gather, breathe that holy name in prayer. Precious, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious, precious name, oh how, sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. precious name of Jesus, how it thrills our souls with joy. When his loving arms receive us, and his songs our tongues employ. Precious, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. At the name of Jesus bowing, falling prostrate at his feet. King of kings in heaven will crown him when our journey is complete. Precious, precious name, oh, how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious, precious name, oh, how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Oh, the precious name of Jesus, how it thrills our souls with joy. When his loving arms receive us, and his songs our songs employ. Precious, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. At the name of Jesus bowing, falling prostrate at his feet. King of kings in heaven will crown him when our journey is complete. Precious, precious name, oh, how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious, precious name, oh, how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven.
Amen.
Welcome to D-Day Sabbath.
Amen. It's a beautiful day and we are so happy to be in the presence of the Lord. We come from different places. In Dominica, there are different areas that we come from. And we may have friends who come from other areas. And if there's anybody from Moriah, Seventh-day Adventist Church with us already, we say welcome to service. We are virtual, but we are together in spirit. Again, we say, what, Hananiah?
Welcome.
This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the
day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made.
We will rejoice. We will rejoice
and be glad in it. And be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice
and be glad in it.
For this is the day.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
This morning program is titled, If My People Pray. I pray that we'll all be blessed by today's worship. As we continue, we'll have our power text by Brother Duran. Is Brother Duran on?
It doesn't look that way.
Okay, 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14 says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land.
Thank you very much, Sister Nalda. Will now be favored by, will now listen to special music. Pray on, for we are who the Lord is looking for.
All right, we'll take it after. All right, good.
Hi everyone, it's Aunt Farinita.
That's not the today, song that you want.
Good, we'll take the song after.
Sabuli said, go ahead, he'll play, we'll take it after.
Yes, Sister Nalda, thanks. What would happen if those in Dominica, in America, in St. Lucia, whatever Caribbean island you come from, or wherever we are, as Seventh-day Adventists, what if we were to pray for the healing of our land? If my people pray, the promise in 2 Chronicles 7:14 can't be done alone, but it needs to start with each person. In a sense, 2 Chronicles 7:14 is a prayer for revival, reformation, and restoration. At this moment, we'll have a minute prayer by Sister Henry.
So you don't make me see food then? I was putting it so.
Dear great and merciful Father, we come before your throne humbly, seeking your forgiveness for all that we have done to displease you. Lord, we ask you to forgive us wherever we have sinned, words, thoughts, deeds, or action. Lord, this morning we come before you, seeking your grace and mercy upon us, Lord. You said that you are very present help in times of trouble. We thank you, Lord, for being present whenever we need you, Lord. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for your grace that you have bestowed upon us, Lord. Without you, we are nothing, Lord. Our lives have no value if you are not in it, Lord. So this morning, I just thank you for being the God that you are to us, Lord. Being so merciful to us as a people, Lord. Every day we need you. Every hour of our lives we need you, Lord. Only you can see what the enemy is up to. So there, Lord, we come before you asking for protection over us, over our land, over our leaders, Lord, over all our members. We come asking you for healing, Lord. So many sickness and diseases are ailing our people, Lord. But you can combat it, Lord. You can defeat the enemy, Lord. You have already won the victory for us, Lord. We are on the winning side. So today, I pray that every man, woman, and child who is in your presence this morning will believe, Lord, that you have already won the victory for us, Lord. And with you, Lord, we can overcome anything, any challenging situation that we may be in, Lord. We ask you to open up our eyes, to open up our minds, Lord, to receive you so that we can be proper representatives for you. And others will be convinced when they look at us. They don't need to hear us or see us going to church. But when they just look at our lifestyle, the way that we behave with others, the way that we treat others, the way that we speak, Lord, the way that we dress, they will be convinced that you are the true God. So today, Lord, I ask you to allow your spirit to speak with to us. And when we hear that voice, we will not turn a deaf ear or a blind eye to it, Lord, that we will answer to your call, because we are all in need of you. We cannot make it without you, Lord. So today I pray that whatever message you have in store for us, we will be encouraged, Lord. Continue running the race. It is not over, and there is so much more to overcome. But I pray, Lord, that today we'll be reminded of your goodness and your grace, that you will help us to overcome and to make it to the finish line. And when all is done, you will say, well done, good and faithful servants. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so very much. Pastor, is the song ready? Okay, well, we'll continue. Am I allowed to share my screen?
We seen your screen, Sister Bully. Go ahead.
If my people pray, as in Corinth, as in 2 Chronicles 7, 14. We are living, we are dwelling in a grand and awful time. It's a time where we hear of earthquakes, the time where we hear of wars, and we are living in a time when coronavirus have many of us scared, or we wonder what next and what is going to happen to this world. It is indeed a grand and awful time. But we have, this verse tells us, the hour has come for you to
wake up from your slumber,
because our salvation is
nearer now than when we first believed.
We need to wake up. Now is the time. This morning we are asked if my people pray. And I know that we all know how to pray. Is the Christian practice that we are taught almost from the cradle. Before we can even read, before children can read, many of them know how to pray. Was that true for you, Hananiah?
Yes.
Very much so. We all know how to pray. So you may be asking, well, what exactly is Sister Bully saying this morning? I know how to pray. But God, when he said these things to Solomon, He is still saying it to us today. If my people pray, it's time to pray. And we ask, but we have been praying all the time. So what is Sister Bully saying? It is time to pray.
Revival praying, the kind that brings real and lasting changes in our homes,
churches, nation, and in our lives. That's the kind of prayer that I am talking about.
It's about honesty and coming to terms with where we really are spiritually and admitting how much we need Jesus. It's time for change, people.
It's time for change. We need to change the way that we pray. You see this little young man I have there? There are sometimes I have to say to him, your prayer is too much the same thing. I heard it the same thing last night. I'm hearing the same thing this morning. You need to pray and really speak to God and know. So there are times I have to say to him, pray again. Because, and then he said to me, but I finished praying. No, we need revival praying. We need honesty in our prayer. We need to come to a point where we can say to God, Lord, my marriage is on the edge of a breakdown. We have to be able to say to God, Lord, my children are going astray and I need you. We need to look and say, Lord, financially, I don't know where I am going to get food for the next day. We need to admit that we need God as much as possible. Why the need for prayer? We are slowly losing the ability to believe in the risen Savior. We are playing church. We look good on the surface, but on the inside, we are a wreck. Persons, it's time for us to pray. We know of God, but the knowledge of Him has no power to bring change. And remember I said earlier, we need change. We have the knowledge of God, but not the power to bring change. We need to stop playing church. We have hard hearts and sharp tongues. We gossip about each other. We tell lies. We backbite each other. Our hearts are heavy. We don't know how to forgive. And this morning, we need that honest kind of that dialogue with God. That is one of why we need prayer.
We don't only have hard hearts and sharp tongues. We also have an unhealthy isolation from the people we are supposed to save.
COVID says we need to have social distancing. But as Christians, do we need to social distance to the people we need to save?
No.
No. We need to find ways in which we can reach people. Today, we need to pray.
We need to pray to stop us from the lack of love and caring to others.
We need to love. Many times we hear in our churches, oh, this person doesn't love and this. But if it starts with us, if I look to love you and you look to love me, then we are going to have a loving community, right? Because as the songwriters say, it's love that makes us happy. It's love that smooths the way. It helps us mind. It makes us kind to others every day. And we know that God is love. Reason for praying, we need to pray so that we can have the love that is needed in our church. There's a dangerous rise in natural disasters and diseases. Brothers and sisters, if my people pray, I will heal their lands. This morning, we need to pray because of the increase of these natural disasters and diseases like COVID and many more. We need to pray.
Praying is not getting God to do what you want. It's not a fast food restaurant creating a heavenly burger where you can have the blessings your way and right away.
Oh no, it is not a fast food joint.
We need to experience the kind of communion with God that will break us free from weak, powerless Christianity, coming face to face, heart to heart, with the God who heals.
We need to pray. Like I said before, we consider ourselves Christians and we have been praying, but we really need to communicate with God so that we can break through. We realize sometimes we pray and we pray and we pray and we see nothing happens or we fail. We need to come face to face and heart to heart with God. Speak to him just like how you would speak to your friend when trouble times are with you.
God is calling his people to pray as if they've never prayed before. My brothers and sisters, it is time for us to pray again. It's time for us to believe that God is able to bring revival to our generation, to bring beauty out of the ashes of our present moment.
Beauty out of ashes for present moment. We need revival for this generation. If we don't pray as we used to, as in James 5:18 that says, if he prayed again and the heaven gave rain and the earth produced its fruit. Some of us may say, but I don't need rain anymore. You know, many times we don't need rain because many of us are not farmers. So we say, oh, what we need rain for so that we can produce fruit. But brothers and sisters, we need to pray so that we will rain with healing, restoration. We have a young generation to save and we need to burn our knees so that we can save that generation.
We need P-R-A-Y, prayer.
We need to pray. We live in a present moment where COVID seemed to be taking over. Dominica just recorded 4 deaths on COVID. And I tell you, brothers and sisters, we need to pray.
All too often, we look to civic organizations or government to find solutions to the world's problems. But the verse does not put the pressure on anybody else. The mandate is to God's people.
If my people pray, he didn't ask for the people that are not of God, the hidden. He said, if my people pray. Many times we go to government, we have problems, we want to go to government, we want to go to this, we want to go to that. We think that the World Organization is going, the World Health Organization is going to take care of all our health problems. We think that the UN is going to take care of all our problems. We think that China is going to take care of our problems. We think that the government, our president, and our prime minister is going to take care of our problems. But this morning I'm here to tell you, as in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people that are called by my name, God has claimed us as his people, and the mandate is on us to pray for what we want.
So we don't have to be putting all the pressure on WHO, the World Health Organization, but we have to pray to WHO, the world's heavenly organization.
Amen, brother. We need to pray for the World Heavenly Organization. God, he asked us to come to him and we need to pray. One of the greatest promises and call for prayer is in the Holy Bible. Hananiah, read that text for me.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and I shall heal their lands.
What a beautiful promise. In these 40 words of promise, God is outlining the method by which we can purchase gold refined in the fire so we can become rich, and white clothes to wear so we can be covered from our shameful nakedness, and salve to put on our eyes so we can see. What a beautiful promise. God wants to refine us. He wants us to become rich. He wants us to have beautiful remnant on our bodies to cover our shameful, and he wants our eyes to be open so that we can see what is happening around us and better prepare us for heaven. We have two divine prescriptions, both of them with if. Do you know that God knows that we sometimes would not go to him? So he used the word if. If this didn't happen and if that didn't happen, we don't want to stay with the ifs this morning. Imagine what would have happened if I did not go to work today. Imagine what would have happened if Hananiah wasn't born. We have two divine prescriptions. Read the first one for me, Hananiah.
If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come.
If my people will humble themselves and pray, I will hear, forgive, and heal. Both telling you that we need to pray. We need to come to God. When we are sick, we go to the pharmacies, we go to our doctors, and they write us prescriptions. God has given us his word so that we can be healed. Forgive and heal.
If God's people pray, the door to a new relationship with Christ is opened.
A relationship we cannot live without, and an offer we cannot refuse. For God has said in Isaiah 43:1,
Fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine.
We are God's. If my people pray, we are his, and he expects us to open the door of prayer. Come in and have a serious relationship with him. If you are in a relationship that's not getting you anywhere, you want to get rid of it. This morning, I want for us to build another. Remember, I said we are not just talking about surface praying, but we are talking about heart searching prayer. Coming to God and know that all things are possible with him, for we are his own and he expects us to look towards him.
According to 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 40, God is waiting on his people to humble ourselves, pray, seek his face, turn from our wicked ways, repent. And once we have done that, his word assures us that he will forgive our sins and heal our land.
When we humble ourselves, pray, seek his face, and turn from our wicked ways, we need to put action. Some of us are too proud. We cannot deal with this person. We cannot deal with that person. I am not in her class and she's not on my level. And we are so proud that we cannot even humble ourselves to go to God in prayer. We have prayer meetings and we cannot even hold the hands of the other person next to us, or we cannot even mention somebody's name in prayer. But God is asking us today that we need to humble ourselves and we need to pray. We need to seek his face and turn from our wicked ways. Brothers and sisters, we cannot still want to harm the other person and expect our prayers to be heard. We cannot hold forgiveness. We cannot be unforgiving to our brothers and sisters and expect our prayers to be answered. We cannot still be housing with the neighbor's wives or the neighbor's husband and expect our prayers to be answered. We cannot have hatred in our hearts and expect our prayers to be answered. We need to turn away from our wicked ways. And once we have done that, his words assure us, and we know that God is not a God that tell lies. Therefore, his words say he will forgive our sins and he will heal our land. What a
mighty God
we serve. Oh, God wants to heal somebody this morning. God wants to forgive sins this morning. And God wants to heal our land. Wherever your land is, be it in the United States, be it in, in Europe, be it in the Caribbean, wherever your land is, God wants to heal. And like I said before, the mandate is on us as God's people.
When God's people pray, number one, there is peace. Number two, we participate in God's power. And number three, the impossible is made possible. Prayers are answered, lives are transformed, and nations are healed.
When God's people pray, there is a peace that passeth all understanding. Peace in our homes, peace in our churches, peace in our communities, and peace in our nation. And peace. Oh, what beautiful peace. I want peace. How about you? We participate in God's power. There is power in prayer. And when we pray, remember he said, what will happen? He will heal our lands. Imagine the Adventist community coming together and praying. What immense power are we going to have to be able to heal our land? What we think is impossible. We may think that this COVID will never end, or we may think that our wars will never end. We'll think that things will never end. But remember, with prayer, the impossible is made possible. God wants to transform our lives. He wants to heal our nation. We need to pray today.
Make sure you're listening to me. What if more than we talked, gossiped, complained, vented, posted, wrote? What if we prayed?
Yes.
I don't think you listen to me right now. Make sure you listen. What if more than we talked, than we gossiped, than we complained, than we vented, than we posted, than we wrote? What if we prayed?
Yes.
God said, with faith as small as a mustard seed, mountains can be moved. So what if we pray?
What if, Hananiah? What if we spend less time posting those status, writing those long things on Facebook? You are right. Mm-hmm. With a little mustard seed of faith, mountains can move. Imagine if all 53 of us this morning for praying together for the healing of our lands. Are you here listening to us this morning? The songwriter says, but when I call on Jesus, all things are possible. I can mount on wings like eagles and soar. When I call on Jesus, mountains are going to fall, because he'll move heaven and earth to come rescue us when we call. So Hananiah, would it be fair this morning to say that there is no healing in our land because we are not praying?
Of course that is fair.
It
what
is.
Kind of question is that?
Of course it is fair. So it is saying that we are not praying this morning. That's why we're not getting the healing that we need. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. Brothers and sisters, that's a serious thing. We don't have healing because we are not praying. We need to pray.
The most powerful weapon against trials
is prayer.
Is prayer. The most effective medicine against sickness is prayer.
So COVID.
And the most valuable gift to someone you love is prayer.
So Hananiah, we don't need the vaccine then. What is it we need?
We need P-R-A-Y-E-R.
Very much so. We need prayer. And the most valuable gift to someone you love is
prayer.
Is prayer. The most valuable gift I would have given to all of my sons is prayer. Whenever somebody would ask me, I would say, please pray for my boys. We need to pray. We have a few Bible examples of prayer.
Let's see how much of them you can remember. The sun and moon stood still when Joshua prayed. Can you remember that one? Esther given favor and the Israelites saved after praying and fasting. God demonstrated his power when Elijah prayed. God gave Hannah the son she so much wanted after she prayed.
I'm sure that many of us have our own examples of how God came through for us when we prayed. It could have been personal or collectively as a church, as a group. The same God who answered all those prayers is the same God we serve today. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. In him, there is no shadow of turning. So when we pray, God hears and he answers the prayers of his people. Let us not take prayer lightly. We need to have those agonizing prayer with and for our people. And God has said, and he has promised, that if we turn away from our wickedness, he will hear from heaven and he will answer.
You know what our problem is?
Tell me.
We talk about prayer. We read about prayer. We have even learned teaching regarding prayer, but we've never prayed.
Now is the time to understand that prayer is
the source of power.
So, you want power? What are we expected to do?
Pray.
We want power. We're expected to pray. And we pray until something happens. We pray until something happens. When God people pray, great things happen. When God comes in contact with man and he hears and answers our prayers, great and mighty things
happen. Do we need healing physical and spiritually?
Yes.
Church, do we need to fill our prescription?
Yes, we need to fill our prescription.
And it all will come in our answer to prayer.
We need to fill our prescription, and it will all come in the answer to prayer. For this week, every time I listen to COVID reports, there's one word that keep coming up, Hananiah. It keep coming up. What word is that?
Get vaccinated.
It says, get vaccinated. God is saying to us this morning that the answer to all our problems if we come to him in prayer. Brothers and sisters, God's people, we need to pray. If my people pray, our lands will be healed.
If we will pray, then he will heal our land. The promise is certain. The only condition, we must pray. According to Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 17, we must pray without ceasing.
Yes, the only condition we have is for us to pray. I will heal your lands, the Lord said. He wants to heal us today. He wants to heal us of all the maladies that we are going through in our homes. He wants to heal us of the bitterness that is eating away from us. He wants to heal us from COVID. He wants to heal us from all the other viruses that's happening. He wants us to be happy. But he has only one condition, and he has asked us to pray. And when we pray, we need to turn away from our wicked ways, and we need to constantly keep in prayer. God is saying to us this morning, let's pray on, for we are who the Lord is looking for. For this will tear those mighty strongholds down. Stay on your knees, For this is where the battle is won. Very soon we'll win the victory. We need to pray on. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their lands. Brothers and sisters, God wants to heal our lands today. What are we saying to him? I need to get that forward, please. We'll now take two testimonies from somebody, anybody, on how God came through with an answered prayer. Pastor, we'll take that song now, please.
Was paralyzed by fear when they heard a mighty multitude was quickly drawing near. But as they prayed for deliverance, the victory would begin. For when you call upon the Lord, you summon all of heaven. Pray on, for you looking for. Pray on, for this will tear those mighty strongholds down. Stay on your knees, for this is where the battle is won. Very soon you win the victory. Pray when Daniel faced the lions for worshiping the Lord, it seems there was no hope at all for what would be in store. But when we stand on holy ground, our smallest prayer is heard. Instead of on our circumstance, our eyes are on the Lord. Go unanswered, and your prayers may seem in vain. They don't seem to make a difference. They don't seem to make a change. Just rest assured God knows your needs, and he hears each time you pray. Your prayers are reaching heaven, and the answer's on the way. Better place for you to be.
Let me give one person the opportunity this morning to give an account of an answered prayer that will help others to realize that we really need to pray.
Amen. Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Good morning.
Good morning. Truly, I just could not miss this opportunity. I just want to tell you this morning, I am so truly blessed by this powerful presentation on prayer. My loving young brother, you have just totally impressed me. And mom, you should be so proud. I am just in awe.
I have my
son and everyone. I am in awe this morning. And I just see the evidence of what prayer can do through this young man of God. To God be all the glory. I know that God has so much more. Oh, I feel it in store for you, my loving brother. And thank you so much, my dear loving sister, for being that example. Prayer, that's what prayer can do. But praise God, I'm thanking God this morning that I am in the land of the living because of the power of prayer. And, it was over 2 years ago that I was hooked up on a ventilator fighting for my very life. And, you know, I tell you, we had a lot of people praying for me. A lot of at Mount Moriah, we have our prayer warriors, and they were interceding on my behalf. And, you know, with tubes all down my throat, connected to all kinds of devices, I could not verbally utter a word of prayer. But, you know, in my heart, with all the tubes in my throat, I looked up to God and I said, Lord, have mercy upon me. And I remember crying out and travailing before God, not verbally, but from the heart, because I was not able to speak. But I'm here to tell you, the young brother said, you know, if we just have the faith tiny as a mustard seed, that mountains can be moved. And believers and friends on this Zoom platform this morning, I'm here to tell you, I asked God, I said, Lord, if you would raise me up from this bed of affliction, I told him that, Lord, I will be a mouthpiece for you. And I will proclaim your healing power and what the power of prayer can do. Believers, the doctors and specialists gave me up. But God, through prayer and intercessory prayer, I am here today proclaiming the power of prayer this morning. Truly, God is amazing. And prayer, believers, changes things, issues, and believers, that the word cannot be so clear. It was so clear this morning. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn. That's the key. Turn from our wicked ways. And if we have problems with that, let's go to God and ask him to eradicate those things that will hinder our prayers to be heard and to be answered. So I just give God thanks because I am here today because of the power of prayer. And I admonish each and every one of us to pray. Pray without ceasing. Thank you for this opportunity. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, sister. And we glorify God and we praise God with you for hearing and answering your prayers. This morning we'll have a spirit of prophecy quote by Sister Flavio.
Sabi, I thought time I take on it. All right, everybody can hear me?
Yes, sir.
All right.
We need to see and hear you. Good morning.
What's that? You can see me, but I have to put on the camera so I can see. So at least see me. Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Sabbath to you, sis.
Happy Sabbath to you also.
I'm reading from the book Prayer, written by E.G. White. On the second chapter, our need of prayer. I'm going to read certain sections of this book. Prayer is as essential to life as daily food. Daily prayer is an essential to growth in grace and even to spiritual life itself, as is temporal food to physical well-being. Am I clear?
Yes, loud and clear. Go ahead.
There, Jesus' disciples had not heeded the repeated warning, watch and pray. The experience of the disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane contains a lesson for the Lord's people today. They did not realize the necessity of watchfulness and earnest prayer in order to withstand temptation. Many today are fast asleep, as were the disciples. They are not watching and praying, lest they enter into temptation. Let us often read and give careful study of those portions of God's word that has special reference to these last days, pointing out the dangers that will threaten God's people. And as I go further down,
we could take that for now, Sister Flavia.
Just one more. Okay, one more sentence. If there was ever time when we should watch and pray in real earnest, it is now.
Amen. If there was a time that we need to pray in earnestness, is now. And our time is fast spent, but we cannot leave this morning if we don't offer at least a prayer this morning. We want to pray for all the healing of our land. We want somebody to pray, not long, half a minute, something of that sort, for the healing of our land. We want another person to pray for our leaders, our world leaders, so that the decisions that they make regarding COVID-19 would be that would benefit us as God's people. We need to pray for the worldwide church that we would carry out the great commission that God has set before us. Three short prayers that will take us about a minute and a half. I'm not going to call names. If you feel impressed, just open your mics and let us talk to the Lord this morning. Remember, short prayers.
Yeah.
For our leaders, for the healing of our lands, and for our church, worldwide church.
Sister, your mic is muted.
Lord, we come before you this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to pray. And dear Lord, you have asked that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us. And when we turn away from our wickedness, that you will heal our lands. Lord, we pray this morning for the healing of our lands, for our homes, our churches, our communities. Lord, you know that there are persons who are breaking apart. There are homes that are falling apart. There are communities that are destroyed, be it by war, be it by gangs, be it by drugs, Father. This morning, I seek healing on this thing, on this land, dear Father. I pray, dear Lord, that you will come through for us. And the Lord, when all is said and done, you'll bring peace to our homes, peace to our communities, and peace to our nation. Thank you, Father, we pray. Amen.
Let us pray, loving God and merciful Father. It is such a joy and a privilege to be in your holy presence. We thank you, dear God, for reminding us of the importance and the necessity of prayer. Lord, in the book Prayer, Sister White said that even Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, relied on prayer, much less for we human beings. And so I pray, O God, that you will endow us with the spirit of prayer. Give us this desire to continue to connect with you. Lord, we ask specifically that God, that you be with our leaders at this time. Now it's a very difficult and a tough time to be a leader. But I ask that you will be with our leaders, be with our prime minister, our president, ministers of cabinet, even as they provide leadership and guidance to us and to Dominica and the world. Continue to be with our people, dear God. Save us, and may we pray more. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, let me say thank you very much for the Sabbath program. And let us remember, if my people pray, that God is willing to listen, to hear, and to answer and heal our land. Pleasant Sabbath, everyone.
To break out room.
Sabbath school is now adjourned until next Sabbath. Sorry, we'll now go to lesson study.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. I was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the bridge was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I at home. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. And thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. And thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The it has washed me white.
Amen. Thank you, sister, for that beautiful song. He has brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Light.
Amen. This morning, our lesson study is going to go in the order of the children's story. Then we'll have the teens and the adults. The adults will be done by Sister Sinofia, Brother Alex, Sister Nalda, and Sister Doreen. Pass the children's story, please.
Okay. Give me.
Or do you want me to go ahead with the teen and then you'll come on with the story, children?
Somebody has a hold on, huh?
Hi, everyone. It's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called Alive Again. The memory verse is from Romans chapter 1, verse 16. It says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. Today's message is we serve when we help others. Mary and her mother had little to live on. They needed food. Their clothes were old and patched. One day, someone told Mary's mother that the Seventh-day Adventist community services in her town could help her. So Mary and her mother went there for help. Soon, they received some food and good, clean clothes. Seventh-day Adventist community services can be found all around the world. Perhaps there is one near you. Sometimes community services are called the Dorcas Society. Why? Well, I'm glad you asked. That's because Dorcas, one of Jesus's friends, helped many people in the village where she lived. Here's her story.
We were all worried about our dear friend Dorcas, Elizabeth began. She is so sick, and she doesn't seem to be getting any better.
I know, responded Sarah. Dorcas is such a precious woman. I love to go to her house. I like to listen to her talk about Jesus. Her big brown eyes sparkle and shine when she talks about him. And I love to hear her laugh. It's wonderful to watch her hands. They're always busy sewing. I do believe she is the best seamstress in the city. Even if the shirt or coat she is making is a simple one, it's always elegant. And then she gives it away to some poor widow in need.
The two women turned back to their work. There was much to be done that day. But first, they would pray for Dorcas. Several days passed. Then early one morning, the news spread through the town. Dorcas has died. People hurried to her house to see if it were really true. They could hardly believe it. Some of the women were already washing her body, tears running down their faces. Then they gently carried her to a room upstairs. Suddenly, amid all the crying and chaos, somebody remembered that Peter was visiting the believers in Lydda, about 10 miles away. Let's send for Peter, they exclaimed. So two men set off to find him.
Finally, Peter came. It was quite a scene that he walked in on. Crying and wailing and mourning. A whole house full of friends in distress. Someone led Peter to the upstairs room. Many widows crowded around him, sobbing. They held the coats and robes that Dorcas had made for them. Peter sent everyone out of the room. Then he quietly knelt beside the bed and prayed. As he stood up, he turned to Dorcas, lying so still. "Dorcas, get up," he called. Immediately, Dorcas opened her eyes and sat up. Peter took her by the hand and helped her out of bed. He smiled at her. Then he called the people back into the room so they could see her too. How the believers rejoiced and praised God! "Our God is so good," they shouted. Dorcas herself was amazed at what had happened. Of course, the wonderful news spread quickly. Everywhere in Joppa, people heard about the miracle. Many people believed that God had restored her life because Dorcas had helped so many others. And because of that, many of them believed in the Lord.
This podcast is read by Franita Bud.
Thank you so much, and I hope that our children learned that God answered prayer, and they learned about Dorcas and the community service department of our church. We'll have a review of the teen lesson study at this moment.
Yeah. Teen.
Good morning. Good morning, Amy.
Good morning, every morning.
Okay. This quarter, the youth are continuing to study principles of biblical sexuality. The principle we studied this week was interconnectedness. Our memory verse was taken from Matthew 7, verses 1 to 5. And in summary, it basically says that it is human nature for us to judge others, look at them, observe them, and point out what they have done wrong. And in this context, when we relate Matthew 7, verse 1 to 5 with our lesson this week, the word wrong would refer to, let's say, for example, if we use a person identify as a homosexual, our nature is to judge them or cast them off. But that's not our job to do. That itself is wrong. So God is saying that we all sin. And when we see others fall into the same thing, we should help them. But our natural instinct is to treat them worse than ourselves. So we should have compassion even towards those we think who have done the greatest sin. Because Jesus did the same for us when he died on the cross. Under see with new eyes, we can go back to Matthew 7 and verse 5, and it says, "Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your other brother's eye." And the lesson reads, "What you may say, I am not promiscuous like the other person who is sitting around as if they have no sense of selfhood. Or you may say, I don't identify as LGBTQ, so at least I'm heterosexual. Oh, but I'm always respectful of the others, other person we use, and make sure they have a good time. It's not like I'm selfish. In our own estimation, there is always a worse sinner than us. If, however, we stop measuring ourselves by low standard of human frailty and saw ourselves in the light of flawless life of Jesus Christ, how extremely sinful we would appear in our own sight. How close are we in our sexual life to the purity of the standard God has for us? Guaranteed, we are all missing the mark, but just how much is determined by looking at Jesus. And when we look at Jesus, we will find that we have a great big plank in our eyes that obstructs our view and our ability to see clearly the lives of others. Perspective is a key to interacting with others in the appropriate manner. We must see ourselves for who we really are, sinful, broken, weak beings. Then we must see others for who they really are, God's creation that he is working tirelessly to win back to himself. What this is showing us is that we should first recognize our own faults. Let God deal with us. Acknowledge that we are sinful and allow God to guide us in the right way. This morning, our Sabbath school was entitled, If My People Pray. Prayer should be a priority in our daily lives because that's how we build a stronger relationship with God. And we were reminded time upon time, if we pray and turn from our wicked ways, then God will heal us. One thing we can take away from this lesson is that we should spend time with God so he can repair us first, and we can therefore go out and show others the love we give.
Amen. Thank you very much, Sister Christmas. And now we'll go to the adult lesson. The different individuals know the days that they are doing, so you can go right ahead.
Good morning, everybody, and pleasant Sabbath to everyone this morning.
Pleasant Sabbath, sister.
We are alive and well, and we are here virtually on God's Sabbath day, worshiping him in spirit and in truth. This week, we looked at lesson 9, and we studied the rhythms of rest. The rhythms of rest, or we could say the pattern of rest. And our memory verse or memory text was taken from Genesis chapter 2 and verse 3. And it says, then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work, which God had created and made. We saw that on the seventh, God rested on the seventh day. He sanctified it. He made it holy. Okay, we saw that on the Sabbath. If we read on the Sabbath, we saw that God created the world. It was without form. There was nothing that was in it. Total darkness. And we saw that God filled the void. He created light. He created oceans, life, birds, everything to make the world come alive. God created. It says that God simply made a day, the seventh day, and he made it special. Even before humanity would dash off to self-imposed stressful lives, God set a marker as a living memory aid. God wanted this day to be a time for us to stop and deliberately enjoy life. A day to be and not to do. To celebrate the gift of grass, the air, the wildlife, the water, the people, and most of all, the creator of every good gift. So God created the seventh day for us to commune with him, a day that we can concentrate on him and think of all the beautiful things that he had created. God knitted the seventh day into time. It says that the invitation would come even after the first couple was exiled from Eden. God wanted to make sure that the invitation could stand the test of time. And so right from the beginning, he knits it into the very fabric of time itself. So during this week, we will study God's wonderful invitation to enter into a dynamic rest again and again with every seventh day. And brethren, we are blessed that God has created the Sabbath day, a day when we can put all our cares aside, a day that we can come to him, to worship him, and to commune with him. If we go on the Sunday, spoke about prelude to rest. And we know that prelude is an introduction to something that is more important. Introduction to something that is more important. And prelude to rest. We saw that God was there in the beginning. The Lord spoke, and it was so. And if we read Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, it says that in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. We saw that God created the earth. He divided the darkness from the light. And if we read Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 31, what evaluation, what indication about creation that was said after every day was spoken? What did God say after every day was created? What did he say?
It was good.
He said it was good.
Very good. Yes, he said that it was good. He said that it was a perfect place. It was very, very good. And we saw that also in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, and Genesis chapter 2, verses 7 and 21 to 24. What was different about the creation of humanity from the rest of the world? Can somebody answer? What was different about creation of humanity from the rest of the world? What did God do?
Step one, he made him man with his hands.
Excuse me?
He created man with his own hands from the dust of the ground.
Mm-hmm. And what does that tell us? By he stooping down and creating man in his own hands from the mud, what does that tell us about him?
That we have special.
Excuse me?
That we are special.
Yes, that we are special. And then he wants us to have that relationship. He wants to have that relationship with each one of us. It says that God stooped and began to shape mud. Humanity's creation in God's image and likeness was an object lesson in intimacy and closeness. He said that he breathed in Adam's nostrils and he became a living being. He said Eve's special creation of Adam's rib added another important element to creation week. Also, it spoke about marriage. Marriage was part of God's design from humanity, a sacred trust between a man and a woman, not a man and a man, or a woman and a woman, but it's between a man and a woman. He said this time when God looked at everything, he made on the sixth day, he reframed something, something different. Then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So we said that on the sixth day, God created humanity, and he saw that indeed it was very good. He wants us to have a relationship with him. He wants us to commune with him. That's why we have the Sabbath, where we can commune with each other as brethren to worship our Creator. He said that, think about how radically different the biblical creation story is from what humanity without the guidance of the Word of God teaches. So we see that when we look at creation, we have to look to the Word of God. We cannot look through man, the scientists and the atheists who believe in all sorts of things like the Big Bang. The world just came about just like that. We as Christians, we do not believe those things. Whatever we believe about creation, it is from the Word of God. Because without the Word of God and creation, we will have some other ideas which are not according to the Word of God. So what should this tell us about how much we need to depend on God's word for understanding and truth? And that is so true. We as Christians, we need to depend on God's word for understanding and for truth. No matter what the skeptics say about creation, we know that it's through God's word we can learn more about creation. Any questions on the Sabbath on Sunday before we move to the next presenter? Okay, there's no more questions. At this time, we move to our second presenter.
So Doreen, go ahead.
Sister Etienne, unmute your mic. Sister Etienne seemed to be having some problems.
They're talking so nicely. All of a sudden, just.
Sister, we're hearing you now. Go ahead.
Good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning to you, sister.
And pleasant Sabbath to everyone.
Same to you.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Loud and clear.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me wish everyone a pleasant Sabbath this morning. Right down, the last one. I am having some little technical difficulty. 1 second, please.
The volume does go in.
We are hearing you.
Sister Etienne, listen, Sister Etienne, listen to me. Just unmute your mic and go ahead with the lesson study, all right? We're hearing you loud and clear. So just unmute your mic and go ahead, okay?
Sister Nalda, can you go ahead with Monday and Tuesday, please? Sister Nalda? Sister Sinofia, is it possible for you to go on with Monday and Tuesday, please?
Okay. Sister Kathy, okay, I'm going to try. I'm going to continue.
Thank you very much.
On the Monday, we're looking at the command to rest. Okay, so everything was created, everything was good, but rested on the seventh day, and everything was complete. God blessed the seventh day, he sanctified it, and he rested from all his work that he had made. And we saw that, unfortunately, Adam and Eve, they were placed in the Garden of Eden, and sin entered because Eve was deceived by the serpent. And when sin entered, everything changed. The world was perfect. But when sin entered, everything change. And because of that change, we had a lot of painful relationship. The commune with God was, you know, it was cut. And the relationship that we had with God, the communion relationship that he had with God, it was dysfunctional. He said that and still, even amid all this, God's Sabbath, it still remains an enduring symbol of our creation, and also the hope and promise of our recreation. If humanity needed the Sabbath rest before sin, how much more so after do we need it? If we needed that rest before sin, so much more now that we need these Sabbath rests. It says that many years later, when God freed his children from slavery in Egypt, he reminded them again of this special day, because that day is very important. So they had to remember this special day, because we know that generation after generation, they had to be reminded of God's special day, the Sabbath rest. We read in Exodus chapter 20, the verses 8 to 11. What does this teach us about the importance of the Sabbath as it relates to creation? What does this day teach us about the Sabbath, the importance of how it relates to creation? Anybody wants to answer? We have over 50-something persons in this chat, and I know some of us that we studied, so we can have a little interaction. What does this teach us about the importance of the Sabbath as it relates to creation?
Good morning and pleasant Sabbath to all.
Yes, sister, thank you.
It says that we should always keep the Sabbath holy.
Mm-hmm.
The Sabbath holy, I think. Mm-hmm.
Okay, she says we almost keep the Sabbath holy. What else does it teach us?
Morning.
Yes. I think that because this is the only commandment who starts with remember, because God knew that in some point we would forget. So he's calling on us to remember this day. This is a day that reminds of creation.
Can you repeat that again, please?
All right, sis.
I was saying that it is a day that this is the only commandment that starts with remember. So just it stresses the importance of that day, because God knew that in some point we would forget. And as we have seen throughout history, that we have forgotten, God's day. So God is calling on us to remember, because it's a day that reminds us of God as a creator and also God as our redeemer.
Amen. Amen. All right.
Sister Sinofia, you know, I want to thank you for, I think you're doing an excellent job, you know, in the lesson this morning. Let me just encourage everybody, brethren, let us share. All right. You know, you don't want to keep everything to yourself in your head. Okay. And for me, this is how I view the lesson study. Everybody has a piece to add to the puzzle. If you leave your piece at home, the puzzle is, you know, incomplete. So brothers and sisters, you know, let us share. All right. But let me just add my piece where the Sabbath is concerned, because for me, the Sabbath, it points to our origin, to our origin. And my brothers and my sisters, if you forget where you came from, you will be confused as to where you're going. Your purpose will be skewed. And so if you think you came from the bosom of an alien named Alfred, that is what you will look for. That is where you'll be headed. But if you know you came from the hands of God, that is where you will go. All right. And so the Sabbath reminds us of our origin. That's why the Bible says we should not forget the Sabbath. All right.
Very good.
So, brethren, let us share. You know, it's an opportunity to express everything that you have studied. Let us put everything on the table and have a wonderful discussion in the name of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Just the Sabbath reminds me that God created me and He's coming back to take me up with Him.
Amen. Yes. Thank you, Brother Hananiah. Okay, we were created to share fellowship with God. Fellowship. It did not matter that the Israelites had been treated as slaves with little worth. With each Sabbath, in a special way, they were called to remember who they really were, beings made in the image of God Himself. So they were called to remember. They were created in the image of God Himself, in spite they were slaves in Egypt. Okay? And since the Sabbath is a memorial of the work of creation, it is a token of love and the power of Christ. This is from Isaiah of Ages, okay? And since the Sabbath is a memorial of the work of creation, it is a token of love and power of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Think about how important the doctrine of a six-day creation is. The doctrine of a six-day creation. After all, what other teaching is so important that God commands that we devote one-tenth of our lives every week?
Okay, Warren.
Is this, want to say something, brother?
Oh, sorry, I didn't realize I was on. Yes, on the question of which we study in the rhythm of rhythm of rest. And you know, God set in motion the rhythm that we work first and then we work first and then we rest. And but some would have us rest first and then work. And the Sabbath is the only day of the week that reminds us of God as creator. When when Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, whatever day comes around, we don't remember God as creator. But every time the Sabbath comes around, it reminds us that we keep the Sabbath because it is the Sabbath of the Lord, and God is the creator of the heaven and the earth.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Morgan. And I was reading that it says, think about how important the doctrine of a six-day creation is. After all, what other teaching is so important that God commands that we devote one-tenth of our lives every week and without exception to remembering it? What should this fact alone teach us about how crucial it is that we remember our true origin as depicted in the book of Genesis? And that's so true, because the Sabbath
It teaches us about our true origin, where we come from, who created us. Any comments or questions before I move on to Tuesday's lesson? New circumstances. Okay, so we're looking at the children of Israel wandering in the land of Egypt, and they were wandering for 40 days in the wilderness. And you know, there are generation after generations, people die, children are born. And some of the statutes and some of the commands that they are supposed to remember how God had led his people before them. Some of them, they may have forgotten about it, and they were not living to the standard they are supposed to live. And it was the duty of the parents to teach the children about what God has said and what they are supposed to do. He said that they were privileged to have the sanctuary in the center of the camp and to see the cloud indicating God's presence hovering over the tabernacle. When it moved, they knew that it was time to pack and follow. This cloud was provided shade. This cloud that provided shade during the day and light and heat at night was a constant reminder of God's love and care for them. So we see that in spite of whatever they were going through, God still provided for them. He took care of them, and he gave them light, and he gave them heat at night to take care of them. So it's just a constant remember that God still loves them and that he cares about them. It says, what personalized reminder of the Sabbath rest did they have? What personalized reminder of the Sabbath rest did they have? What did they have? What happened to them when they were in the wilderness? What happened to them? What did God tell them to do? What were they not supposed to do? And I need someone to answer me. I am not speaking alone. When they were in the wilderness, what did they do? Excuse me?
The collecting of the manna.
Yes, the collecting of the manna. Okay, so how many days would they gather manna?
40. They had to collect manna every day, but on Friday they would have to collect for Friday and for Sabbath. No, if they collected on for Monday and they took extra to store for Tuesday to make worms, mm-hmm. but when they took on Friday, those they took for Sabbath, nothing mm-hmm. affected.
Very good. Thank you. Amen. So we see that God is a God of order. And what he says to do, that is what to
it. Every day they have to call it.
Do. Yes, I heard someone else talking.
I was just asking, is there a message in that? Because, well, from one of the things that I learned is that God...
Are you far from your mic?
No, I'm not. I'm trying to be as loud as possible. Are you
hearing
me?
Okay, I know that you clearly. Okay.
Are you hearing me better?
A little better, yes.
Okay, you can go on. Hello?
Yes, I'm hearing you clearly. You can go on.
I'm not hearing me if you're hearing me.
I am hearing.
Go ahead, I can
hear you. Okay, let me hear. I think I heard Nala's question. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me attempt to answer. Oh, my phone go. Wow. You can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you clearly.
Okay, well, when I was asking whether there's any lesson for us in what mm-hmm. happened in the desert, mm-hmm. the lesson here for us is that the Sabbath existed before Sinai.
Yes.
In fact, God gave them the Sabbath even before giving them the Ten Commandments at Sinai. And the reason he told Moses was that he would see whether they would, by giving them the Sabbath, if they obeyed his Sabbath, then they would obey his laws and his commandments.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That was a test for the people. That's the lesson there for us.
Okay. All right. Anybody else?
Yeah. Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Morning.
From Mount Moriah.
Okay.
Yes, with regard to a lesson, we see that the Lord, he instructed them to collect manna every day. On Friday, preparation day, they were supposed to collect enough for Sabbath, right? And then we see in the scriptures that when they disobeyed, for instance, if they collected more than enough during the week, we see that it would gather worms and it would, you know, stink, right? Mm-hmm. However, we see that we have such an amazing God that when they collected for Sabbath, it remained fresh. Mm-hmm. So we see that God, he is a God, as you rightly pointed out, a God of order, yes. A God who is so amazing. And that is why we have to trust him. Amen. Amen.
Yes, amen, amen. Thank you, sister.
Thank
you. It says that I'm looking on the Tuesday. I just want to read a paragraph or two here. He said the special food that God supplied was a daily reminder of the fact that the Creator sustained his creation. In a very tangible way, God was supplying their needs. Every day was a miracle, with the food appearing and disappearing with the sun. Anytime that anyone tried to hoard for the next day, it would rot and stink. And yet,
the sun.
Every Friday, there was enough for a double portion, and the leftover to be eaten on Sabbath remained miraculously fresh. What an amazing God we serve. He says also that this new generation finally was poised to enter the promised land. Israel was about to undergo a change of leadership, and an age Moses wanted to ensure that this generation would remember who they were and what their mission was. He did not want them repeating the mistakes of their parents, and so he repeated God's laws. The Ten Commandments were repeated so that this generation, poised on the brink of conquering Canaan, would not forget. And that also refers to us today, that we will teach our children so that this generation, they would not forget when we are here, when we are no longer here, that our children will continue to teach their children about the love of God and the commandments that they are supposed to be keeping.
Amen.
Any questions? Any questions on the Tuesday? I have a question.
I have a question too.
Okay, Sister Flavia, go ahead with your question.
We do not have to collect manna.
No, that's true.
But what can we avoid, or what can we do to avoid the mistakes of the children of Israel from happening to us?
That's a very good question. Question to the class. We do not have to collect manna, but what can we avoid from doing the same mistakes that the children of Israel did?
It simply means that we have to prepare beforehand, prepare for during the week for the Sabbath.
Okay. So that's
we need to guard the edges of the Sabbath very, very carefully.
Yes, that is true. Because sometimes some of us, what happen when the sun is done, some of us, we are also, we are in the supermarket still doing our last minute shopping before we go home. This is not
something. I have observed that when I visit other churches,
yes,
some persons say they thirsty. They are thirsty, they're going to buy a bottle of water.
Excuse me?
Yeah, I saw that happen in Dominica.
Oh.
They're going to buy a bottle of water in the shop because they are thirsty. Isn't that treading on forbidden ground?
Of course it is. Isn't there water in the church? That the person has to go and buy water?
Well, it is chlorinated, so they want bottled water.
But that's okay. That's what we're saying again. We must be prepared.
We know that when we are coming to church, if we have to drink water, we bring our own water from our home, because if we want chlorinated water, we bring water from our home to church, so that when we are thirsty, that we will drink our water. So these are all the things that we as Christians, Seventh-day Adventist Christians, that we have to guard against.
Our relationship with God mm-hmm. enables us to do much.
Yes.
If we have a relationship with God and we know what the Sabbath means to us, mm-hmm. then everything sets itself in motion. Our mm-hmm. preparation, the day, the what we do and what we say on the day. So if we know we are going to go out, then we make preparation for that. And if perchance something were to happen, circumstances beyond our control, mm-hmm. the God that I serve, and I'm sure that the God that the others serve and we serve, always makes a way for his people.
Amen.
Sister Flavia, I mean, we may laugh at the question, but that is very significant. Sister mm-hmm. Bully, I think you complimented that question pretty well. Because, I mean, think about it, literally. God gave us 6 days, right? You have 6 days to buy a bottle of tap water.
I know.
You know, and then you come into church and you're thirsty, you don't have water, you know? And come on. You know, and so when we understand that every Sabbath is a date with God, you make preparations for it. You know, sure. God could have said, listen, the Sabbath, I'm giving you 6 days for the Sabbath, one day for, you know, for preparation. You're not going to have time to do anything. But God is so lenient and so merciful. He says, all right, you know what? Do everything. Cook your like a pilau, your like a lentils. 6 days, do everything. And one day, let us spend it together. Mm-hmm. That shouldn't be too hard for us. You know, so I think that is a significant question that you're asking, Sister Flavia. Go ahead.
Reference to the question, Sister, or the statement Sister Flavia made. I think the reason for this, people would go and buy a bottle of water saying that I'm thirsty on the Sabbath, is because the whole world see breaking the Sabbath as not being seen.
That's so right.
Some Adventists feel the same way, that we can violate the Sabbath and that is not seen. But I need to ask this morning, is the violation of the Sabbath sin? And if violating the Sabbath is sin, why do we call people from other denominations Christians when we know that they are sinning every day, every week? They violate the Sabbath. And we even call them our brothers and sisters. Is breaking the Sabbath sin?
Violation of the Sabbath is a sin. Is a sin. And for the quarter question you asked Brother Morgan in relation to calling the Sunday persons who go to church, we call them Christians. Some people might say that probably haven't reached to the full acknowledgement of the truth. That is what they have for
knowledge. You know, brother, you ask it controversial question, but you're a brave man, so I respect that. I would say that God winks at ignorance, you know, and so who are we to judge, you know? So that's why it's our responsibility, you know, to teach, you know, and to the world. So let us just say God winks at ignorance, and probably they don't know. So we have a responsibility to go out. That's why we can't sit down in church. We have to go out and let folks know, you know. I see Sister Giselle, your hand is up, Sister Pascal. So Sister Sinofia,
go ahead. Yes, Pastor.
All right, so take Sister Giselle and Sister Nalda, and then we need to move on.
Yes, okay, all right. Yes, Sister Giselle.
Okay, so my question is that, why do we focus so much on what we shouldn't do on the Sabbath as opposed to what we should be doing?
Good question, Sister.
That's a good question, very good question. Why do we focus so much on what we shouldn't do than what we should be doing? Who wants to answer Sister Giselle's question?
Sister, I agree with, I somewhat appreciate that question, because mm-hmm. many a times I try to teach my children what they should know. Mm-hmm. If, and it's like with the money, if we know, if we learn what the real money is like, we have no reason for us to learn what counterfeit money is. Because when we see the real one, we know that it is real. If we spend more time doing the things that is expected of us, we won't have time to do the things that we shouldn't. So yes, if we learn and we practice the things that need to be done, what we need to do on the Sabbath, then there will not be time, nor place, nor energy for what we shouldn't do. If we obey, we follow, and we prepare and plan, then we won't have to be told what we shouldn't. But we find ourselves many a time saying what we shouldn't because we are not doing what we should. So if my boys don't do what they should, I cannot tell them what not to do.
Sister Kathy, I beg to differ. In the book of Leviticus, when God outlined the animals that the children of Israel should eat, he also told them what they shouldn't eat. So
I am not saying that we shouldn't tell, but I say if we know what we should do, then we won't spend so much time on what we shouldn't do.
All right, good. Okay. All right.
Sister Nala?
Sister Nala, all right. Okay, so Sister Nalda, go ahead. Sister Nalda, your mic is extremely low. I'm not sure what's the problem here.
I think you need to go ahead, Sister. I will contribute at the end.
Go ahead.
Okay, I was simply saying it all comes down to our relationship with God. We have to examine that. Examine our relationship with God. Then there would not be a need for certain things, as Sister Kathy said, to be pointed out. Because if we live according to the word and we set the example, then those following after would not have to tell them, then you're not supposed to do this on Sabbath. You're not supposed to conduct certain activities on Sabbath. If we live the life, live according to the word, then this coming after, following after, will pattern after what they see.
All right. Let's try to go quickly. Sister Sinofia, we are consuming our time. I think we have consumed our time, basically. So let's just copy. All right, go ahead. And
since I just said that we have exceeded our time, then we can go on to the next presenter for Wednesday and Thursday.
Okay, all right.
Brother Alex, take it away.
Morning. Yeah, amen.
You're a bit low, but we can hear.
Wednesday this morning, good morning, church. Our topic here is another reason to rest. So before I do anything, I heard we are talking about what we should do and what we shouldn't do, and we have some different questions. But I believe if we're living in the time of Israel, maybe we'd have been dead already because, you know, God was joking in the Thames there. Anyway, you see, another reason to rest. It says Israel had come on the eastern side of the Jordan. They had taken possession of the land of the king of Bashan and kings of Amorai. And once again, in this crucial moment, Moses called Israel together and reminded them for the covenant made at Sinai was not just for the parents, but for them also. He went to repeat the Ten Commandments again for their benefit. So here we see now, God is always interested in letting his people know what they should know. You see, in life, in our weekly work, we are very busy bodies. We don't have time. But here we see that God is reminding us that the Sabbath day is still relevant, even to Christians this day. You know, God always cares. You're tired, but there is a day of rest for you. And so we cannot miss that something happening there, because as a matter of fact, we observe that God has given us 144 hours for ourselves, and he has only taken 20 for himself, but sometimes we still want more to work because we think that we have a lot of things to achieve in life. Now it says, what is the difference in the way the Sabbath command was expressed in them? When you read these two texts, we see that once they remember, once they observe or keep. However, now we see that the Sabbath was to remind them that the same God was active in the creation story, also was active in their deliverance. The Lord who brought you out from there was strong hand and outside hand. So we realize that in our own way that Israel was enslaved in Egypt. And God was to redeem them after the 400 and plus years of hardship. Now, today we are not in any slave work. We're not physically slaves. But I mean, like sin has made us slaves, right? Sin has made us slaves. And so we are under some hard circumstances which we cannot get out. And it's only through the power and the authority of God that we can be delivered. Just 450 years ago. Amen? Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me?
Yes, we. Hello?
Yes, brother, I'm hearing you.
Okay. And it says, I'm hustling, I'm running along. It says, and because Exodus was a symbol of freedom from sin, that is redemption, we find in the Sabbath a symbol of both creation and redemption. And here in a very real way, the Sabbath points us to Jesus, our Creator, and our Redeemer. So we see that the Sabbath is not a burden as the Bible describes it. The Sabbath is a delight, the Sabbath is a day to worship, in spirit and truth, the Sabbath is a day where we can rest from our hard work, and not only ourselves, but our animals too. Your vehicle is tired of running, right? Is forehead tired? It is missing something. But anyways, that is how we should observe it. Let's go on the first week. Keeping the Sabbath, right? For the Christians, the Sabbath should not be an event, but rather a lifestyle. Amen.
Amen.
Sabbath should not be an event. Like is every Saturday morning when we wake up, we have to go to church then. But it should be a lifestyle. From when we leave church this afternoon, our focus should be on what is going to happen next about. What is going to take place? Are we ready to praise God? Are we ready to do our honest part for God? You see, it says God commanded people to keep the Sabbath day, right along with not murdering and not stealing. It's a commandment to remember the Sabbath, even though the Bible doesn't give us specific on exactly how we are to keep this about. Now, there are people that wait when sunset, or we call it sundown, that is when they give up the work, right? But I believe now when the sun sets, it is the time for us to be worshiping if we are planning to worship. As a matter of fact, we should be worshiping at sundown. So I believe that 1 hour before the sunset, we should have put down every tool, every manner of thing that we use for work, put it on our side, and then go and bathe and get ready for sunset to praise God as it is.
All right, Brother Alex, you have two questions. Sister Giselle and Shannon, they have two questions for you. So Sister Giselle, go ahead and then Sister Morgan. All right. Unmute your mic, Sister Giselle, and go ahead. Listen, Brother Alex.
Oh, hold on. Sorry. My hand is up accidentally.
Okay. All right. Okay, Sister Shannon has a question for Brother Alex. Go ahead, unmute your mic, and go ahead, Sister Shannon. All right, Alex. Brother Alex, go ahead. All right.
What should be the atmosphere to create and promote on Sabbath days, right? We see that on Psalm 92 and Isaiah 58 and 13, right? Now, Sabbath day should not be a day of gloom, as the writer says there. Sabbath day should be a day of revival for the hardworking Christian. It should be a day to give thanks. It should be a day to share your testimony in church. It should be a day to ask your brother or invite your brother to come have a meal with you at your home. Sometimes you just wait as it's over. Happy Sabbath, brother, how we say it, and then we stop here. But that is not it. It says because Sabbath keeping means celebrating creation and redemption, its atmosphere should be one of joy and delight in the Lord and not of gloom. You see, God doesn't want us to have happy. God doesn't want us to come to church feeling bad. No, but we should come with a spirit, a thankful, a grateful spirit to worship. Because remember now, when it comes to church on Saturday, it is not about what we receive, you know, but it's what we have to offer. Somebody may be going for a rough time, and the encouraging words that we give to them is enough to make that person praise the God and feel good for the rest of the week. Remember the Sabbath concept begins on the seventh day. As the first Sabbath was the culmination of the creation week, so we should remember the Sabbath day all we can plan ahead, so we can set aside our weekly work and keep it going when the Sabbath comes around. So I heard you're speaking about people saying the first day on Sabbath morning. As Pastor said earlier, then you should have your bottle already well frozen. And on Sabbath morning, you take it out from your freezer and you come to church if you expect to drink some cool water on that day. And not just water alone, any other nice fruit juice or some help. You know, but sometimes we think that, you see, but the item here, today is not our day. We have six long days for ourselves. We have done our part. Now it is God's day for us. Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
All right, you have a minute, brother.
Yes, sir.
Right, that's it.
I'm to the last part. It says Sabbath keeping means friends. God provides time for fellowship with the whole family and includes rest for the rest of the servants and the family animals. And so therefore, I believe that on the Sabbath day, sometimes we do not. Sometimes on the Sabbath, we do not, but our servants, they are still working. In the Sabbath, I believe. And you, the animal should not be working. Your vic, your washing the clothes in the back, at the back for you. Everything should be given to this.
Amen. And to bring our lesson this morning to a close, I'm going to give you one sentence, and it says, take a breather. Rest. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Take a breather. Rest. Thank you very much to everyone who assisted us to bring our lessons. And I pray and trust that we all learn something, the children, the teens, and the adults. Beautiful lesson. We need to rest. God gave us a Sabbath day to remind us that he is creator and redeemer. We'll now be favored with special music by Sister Nalda as we bring our Sabbath school to a close.
So, Bully, you put me on Sabbath school special music mode. We are going to sing hymn number 476, Burdens Are Lifted at Calvary. There's a field with sorrow and care. Hearts are lonely and dread, but as I lifted a Calvary, Jesus is very near. But as I lifted a Calvary, burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. Cast your care on Jesus today. Leave your worry and fear. For burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. Burdens are lifted at Calvary.
Jesus is very near.
Amen.
Amen.
Sister Georgina, Sister Lauren, take us to the throne of grace as we end. Sister Georgiana Laura, please.
Probably she has technical difficulties. All right. Unmute your mic, Sister Georgiana. All right. All right. Unmuted. You're still muted.
Father, now God, we thank you for the Sabbath. We thank you for your Sabbath school. And I pray, dear Lord, that we each learn something that will draw us closer to you. And I pray, dear Lord, that we, as we leave here today, let us take the experience of 2 Chronicles 7 and verse 14 with us. And Lord, let us make a conscious effort to pray, to turn from our wicked ways, and you'll forgive us and heal our lands. Thank you for that promise, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hand it over for announcements and pleasant Sabbath to all.
All right, Sister.
Good morning to all. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
For today, there will be an island-wide half night of prayer. It begins tonight from 7. Please join in for this. Also, this afternoon, we have AY from 4 p.m. Board meeting for Mount Carmel on the 5th of September, Maru River the 7th, Castle Bruce the 12th, and Bataka the 14th. Also, we now have a YouTube page and are currently streaming on YouTube. So I'm asking all members to please subscribe. The YouTube name is Eastern District SDA Church. And there's a letter from conference. To all directors, pastors, and presiders. Greetings from headquarters. Today we can exclaim that our God is faithful. As a conference, let us continue to be steadfast, especially during these trying times. From correspondence received from the Caribbean Union, I wish to share the following information with you. Please take note that the Inter-American Division has officially begun the new quinquennium. Was I pronouncing properly?
Just say 5 years.
Pardon me?
Just say 5 years. That's
Oh, 5 years, and several meetings have been justifiably called to enhance the strategic agenda for evangelistic glass ceiling by the Holy Spirit on Wednesday, September 1st, 2021. I made a mistake there. Let me take that again. The 5 years and several meetings have been justifiably called to enhance the strategic agenda for the entire territory. To this end, the IAD will be launching a special initiative, Breaking the Evangelistic Glass Ceiling by the Holy Spirit, on Wednesday, September 1st, 2021, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. for the English-speaking unions. The following leaders are invited: conference administrators, departmental directors, all pastors, conference information technology personnel, first elders, personal ministries leaders, and youth leaders of each church. I am aware that there are many programs going on, and some of you may have to rearrange your schedules. Nevertheless, I implore you to make an extra special effort to attend and ensure that the required persons are also in attendance. The Zoom link will be sent subsequently. And this is from Pastor Danfor Francis, the President and Religious Liberty Leader Director. Thank you for listening. That's all the announcements for today.
Thank you. Sanala, unmute your mic. Your mic is muted.
Unmuting passed. Okay, thank you very much, everybody. To before we go into our divine hour, we're going to turn our hymnals to hymn number 216, 216. Wherever you are, we invite you to join with us as we sing "When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder." Out there, when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the stars of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll is called up yonder, when the it's all up yonder, and it's all up yonder. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share. When his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is there, let us labor for the master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us stock up for his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, and the roll is called up yonder, when the road is called up yonder, when the road is called up yonder, I'll be there. Amen. What about you this morning? When the road is called up yonder, I'll be there. Hymn number 86, how great thou art. This morning we serve an awesome God, a God who is able to make the impossible possible. Oh Lord my God, when I know someone does consider all the world's thy hands have made. I see the stars of heaven falling from the light of blue
the universe displays, cleansing my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forests I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great you are, Lord. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou And when I think that God, his Son, Lord's very, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my bodily bearing, he bled and died to take away our sins. Then sings my Savior God to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great. Amen. How great thou art. And even as we go into our divine hour, let us prepare our hearts for this morning service as we sing the first stanza of It Is Well With My Soul. Wherever you are, join us in singing. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sounds like sea the ocean roar, It is well with my soul.
it is well, is it well with my soul, with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Sister Naldo. The order of the service will be placed on the screen. And just take a quick glance as to where you fall in on the program, because it will be unannounced. All right, so Sister Naldo, we'll have a call to worship by Brother Clint, our invocation, a welcome by Pastor Henry. Then our scripture by Sister Nesma, then our prayer by Sister Lando, then we'll have our special music for Tori by Sister Christmas, then a special music, then intro of the speaker, and we'll have the word, then the benediction, and the closing hymn and the benediction. All right, so those of you who are on the program, just glance, you know, so you can know where you're coming, so that we won't have to announce the program. All right.
Brother Lando, my pastor. Brother Lando, you said sister. Where is the brother, not the sister?
Well, the two shall become one. All right. All right, Sister Nala, just sing one verse for prayer song, and we'll go into a call to worship. One verse. Holy, holy. And we will go into or divine hour prayerfully. What is the Nalda?
Pastor, I do not know that one. Not holy, holy, but we'll sing. We can sing.
Sing the one you know.
Okay, let me just do the second stanza of It Is Well With My Soul, and then we'll move on.
All right, okay.
My sin, oh, the joy of His glory. Glorious word, my sin, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. He's the Lord. It is well, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well, it is well with my soul.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Call to worship. Let us then hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we have a great high priest who has gone into the very presence of God, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us be brave, then approach God's throne, where there is grace. There we'll receive mercy and find grace to help us just when we need it. We'll now sing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures there below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
And let us pray. Father in heaven, this morning,
we thank you for yet another Sabbath. Lord, although we are in different locations, different countries, different churches, even different homes, we are happy this morning that you are the God who is omnipresent. And we know that wherever we are this morning, that you are with us. So at this time, oh God, we ask you to open the Holy of Holies. Give us a glimpse of the Shekinah glory of God. And loose now the anointing in this place, because it is the anointing that will break the yoke. Bring us into a closer union with you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Amen, amen, amen. Good morning again, everybody. I think it is still morning time, so I can say good morning safely.
Morning, all right. Pastor.
All right, all right, all right. Let me say, happy Sabbath to each one of you. It is so good to be back in the virtual house of the living God. You know, wherever we are, physical, virtual, it's the Lord's house. And so it is good to be back, you know. God has been so, so good to us. Not only this week or yesterday, or, you know, God has been good to us all the days of our life. And so I want us to do an exercise. If you want to show some gratitude today because of how good God has been to you, put your hands in the air like Jesus care, amen, and say, God is good. I may not be able to hear you, you know, but just shout and blow your roof away and say, God is good. And all the time, God is definitely good. This morning, it is my duty and also my pleasure to welcome you to service. You know, and all those of you who have decided to be part of this experience, we are glad to have you. We are excited that you are here. You know, we are on Zoom. We are also on YouTube. Next Sabbath, we'll be on Facebook. You know, but we're taking everything in strides. But wherever you are on YouTube, on Zoom, on Facebook, wherever you are in the, you know, we wanna welcome you to service this morning. All right. To the members of Mount Moriah. You know, I for the entire morning I've been trying to conceal and, you know, contain my excitement, but I'm just happy to have you here, members of Mount Moriah. We want to, you know, welcome you to Dominica. All right. And let me tell you something about Dominica. Dominica is the land of sun, rivers, mountain, dashing, fig and fish. Amen.
Amen.
So, that's right, brother Honoré. You know, I don't want to tease you before you preach, but it's the truth, all right? Mountain, fish, dashing, tut bite, all right, for reading and everything. And so we are happy to have you here, and we certainly hope that it is not your last. Okay, all right. So members of Mount Moriah, Florida, thank you for joining our service today. My mother, I believe, is on this. I think is on Zoom, and my grandmother, my auntie, my niece, and my cousin, everybody, the whole crew is on board, you know, with me this morning. I want to thank you, family. You know, thank you for being here with us. Welcome to the Eastern and the Southeast District, members of the Eastern and the Southeast District. You know, as I describe it, this is the Holy Alliance, you know, and I am really enjoying our time together, members of the Southeast and the Eastern District, my good people. We want to welcome you. I think Sister Roy George, I gave you an invitation this week. If you are here, I am happy, you know, I'm giving you a high five. You know, welcome into the virtual house of the living God today. All right. Also, the Vidal family, welcome. Michado, all of you, you know, we have indeed happy to have you here. I'm just flashing from my screen, you know, and the names I'm not so familiar with. You know, I'm welcoming you here, Claire, JB, but everybody, you know, all our 67 contacts. I think we have about 10 persons on YouTube. We want to welcome you here this morning, and we pray that you will enjoy your sitting in the presence of the Lord. Welcome one, welcome all, and God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Philippians chapter 3 and verses 13 to 14. I will read in your hearing, and it says, "Brethren, I count not myself
to have apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Brother Lando, if you're speaking, we're not hearing you, so you need to get your mic and go ahead and pray.
Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank thee once again for life spared. We thank thee for your mercies towards us during the course of this week. We thank thee, Father, that we are among the living and not the dead. We thank thee, Father, that you have been our God and be our provider in all things during the course of that week that has just passed. And we thank thee, Father, also for protection which you have given us. We at this time, the Father, want to present everybody before thee at this time. We do thank, we ask the Father that even as your word is being preached at this moment, that it will go forth, the Father, and conquering and to conquer. We do present our visitors, the Father, before thee. Those who are sick, we do ask the Father that you'll continue the process of healing. And as the healing is complete, the Father, that your name will be glorified. Once again, the Father, we present the speaker of your word, the presenter at this time. We do ask the Father that you'll anoint him, the Father, and as he's preached your word, we want to ask the Father that he'll find lodging places in our hearts, we ask, in Jesus' name.
All right, let us sit back and listen to special music from the Badville sister, from the sister. All right, we have been difficulties with this particular song. I'm not sure why. Okay. All right. All right, we're having some technical difficulties with that particular special music. I'm not sure what the case is, but we'll have to, it's just, I don't know. Hmm? It's not going. All right. Let's see.
The lost years and the streets.
Chuka, go ahead.
At this time, I would like to encourage everyone to save their offerings in a safe place and to be collected at a specific time. Deuteronomy 31:6 says, be strong and of good courage. Do not fear, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord your God, he is the one who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. With that being said, I hope we continue to have faith and trust in all God. We'll now pray over the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for bringing each and every one of us here at this meeting. I hope that you continue to guide and protect us, and that the offering which we have collected, that it will be used for your good. In your name I pray. Amen.
Ooh, I used to walk, talk, look just like you. And you were the one before trouble came, always kept praying. Now I was going places I wasn't sent, was going through some changes, straying away from you to distraction. I was true, my thoughts of you were few. Lord, kill my flesh, break my desires. Lord, help me thirst after your righteousness. Kill flesh now, Lord, here I am. I don't wanna be the same. I thank you I'm not that girl again. Lord Jesus, I thank you. Never caring at all, never mind if I fall. I was so fearful. My purpose had died, there was no hope inside. Never thought about the Bible. But it was only God's grace brought me back on the path to find my way. There were no friends to say that love would never go away. I had to cry that day. Lord, 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 Lord. Heal my flesh, break my desires. Lord, help me thirst after your righteousness. Kill flesh now, Lord, here I am. I don't wanna be the same. I thank you I'm not that girl again. Kill my flesh, break my desires. Lord, help me thirst after your righteousness. Kill flesh now, Lord, here I am. I don't want to be the same. I thank you I'm not that girl again.
Amen, amen, amen. And I thank God for people who can sing, because it certainly, you know, makes a difference in our worship service. Now it is time for what you have all been waiting for, you know, and last week Sister Yvonne described it as the main meal. All right, somebody's coughing. So let's just mute our mics, everybody. All right. It is time for the word. It is time for the word. And so today, the one who will speak to us is Dr. Pastor John Honore. And Pastor Honore hails from the beautiful island of Dominica. Of course, he was born in the village of Vicas, all right? He is the 11th of 13 children. Also, he is married to Madrina from the village of Thibault, Dominica. And they have been married for 35 years, a union that has produced 3 adult daughters and 3 grandkids. Dr. Honoré is the pastor of Mon Moriah SDA Church in Hallandale, Florida, and part of the Florida Conference. He is also the program director and business professor at Kaiser University, Miami. And he, Pastor Honoré, tries to model his life after Matthew 4:19, which says, "And he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And I must add, you know, to all of that, that Pastor, you know, Honoré has a very soft spot for the Eastern District, you know, but he has an even softer spot for the Kalinago territory, you know. And we are, Pastor Honoré, it is a pleasure, it is a joy to have you here with us, and I know, I'm almost certain that we will all be blessed by the word God has laid on your heart. So may God continue to bless you and your family. Pastor Honoré, God bless you. The floor is yours.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Henry. I knew the last time I was in Dominica, I met Pastor Henry at the Bourne Church, but I understand now he has been transferred to the Eastern District there in Dominica. So let me say, Pastor Henry, I want to say thank you for your kind words of introduction. And I want to say thank you so much as well for giving me the invitation to use your pulpit, although virtually, and to speak to your district. And I understand that the Southern District, Southeast District, has also joined you this morning. Let me say a special welcome as well to your First Lady, Sister Henry. We want to say thank you. My wife and myself and our church are honored to be part of your service today. I understand that Pastor Bacchus is the pastor for the Southeast Division. So Pastor Bacchus, let me as well greet you and your family, your wife and your family, in the wonderful name of Jesus. Let me welcome again the East District. I understand that we have the East District comprises Cassibrus. Is there anybody from Cassibrus this morning? Would you just wave your hands, anybody from the Cassibrus Church this morning? If you would just wave your hands. And are there anyone from the Mount Carmel Church and Maho River, as well as Bataka? And for the Southeast District, we have La Plaine, we have Guedica, we have Rivia Sirik, and we also have the Warner SDA Church. And I want to say that although I am a born Dominican, I know that many of those villages that I do not know. So this morning, I am rather humbled, and I am honored this morning to be chosen as your speaker. Let me say this morning, I would not be a pastor without the Mount Moriah congregation. And I want to say thank you to all of our Mount Moriah members, those who are viewing on YouTube and Facebook, and those of you who are constantly supporting the ministry here in South Florida. I want to say a very, very special thank you. I know that we have people from as far this morning as Panama and North Carolina and in between. So this morning, we want to give a very, very special shout out to you as we worship here with the South and Southeast District there in Dominica. Let me say thank you to the Badwell sisters for what beautiful voice as they sang to us, "Kill my flesh, break my desire, and let me thirst after your righteousness." This should be the prayer of everyone this morning. asking the Lord to kill the flesh, break our desire, and also let us thirst after your righteousness. So as I look at the time, Pastor, I see that it is 12:07, and I'm not sure how much time that I have to speak, but I pray that you'll give ear this morning as God speaks to me and as God speaks through me. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, I stand this morning before you like Isaiah, a man undone, a man of unclean lips. I pray this morning that you would take some live coal from off of the altar, and I would pray that you would lay it upon my tongue. I pray that you would touch my heart, God, and I pray that you would speak to me and through me. I pray this morning that Pastor Honore will not be seen, but that Jesus will be seen and Jesus will be heard, and that Jesus would be exalted. I pray this morning that Jesus would be uplifted, who said that if I be lifted up, that I would draw all men unto me. I pray this morning, oh God, that somebody under the sound of my voice who is still in the valley of decision, Lord, would hear the word of salvation and would give his or heart to Jesus. Take the service now, visit every home, and bring us, oh God, into a perfect union with you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Amen. So again, special thanks to, again, the Eastern Southeast District and Pastor Henry and Pastor Bacchus. And again, Mont Moriah, thank you so much for your support this morning. As my sister read our scripture reading this morning was from Philippians chapter 4 and verses 13 and 14. It's a well-known verse to many of us. The Bible says, or Paul says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. He says, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And this morning, I simply want to speak to you, or have captioned my message this morning, press on, press on. This morning, my believers and friends, we are dwelling in a grand and awful time. In an age of ages telling, to be living this morning is a supply. Hark the waking up of nations, Gog and Magog to the fray. Hark what soundeth is creation groaning for her latter days. I know that we are living now in a global pandemic. So I know that Dominica is affected as much as we in the United States of America. But church, this morning I've come to tell you that in spite of this pandemic, I believe that God has called you the Eastern District, and God has called you the Southeastern District, and God has called you Mount Moriah for something greater than this. I know this morning that times are frustrating and times are hard, and many people have lost their jobs, lost their income, and putting many people this morning in financial hardship. Many this morning, even here in this country, are losing their homes and losing their cars. And probably this morning you are saying, Pastor, you are speaking to me. You don't know me, but you are describing me. You're saying, Pastor, it is hard. Many a person did not sleep last night, or many a person has not been able to sleep last night because there is so much on their mind. The pressure is too great. This morning, you are despondent, you are dejected, you feel defeated, you are discouraged, you are disconsolate, you are confused. Oh, this morning, in this pandemic and in these times, my friends, where moments like this will occur that alters our direction in life. Am I talking to somebody this morning? A moment, a time that made you question even what you believed. It is a moment that has the ability to shake you to your core, and the things that were once certain now seems uncertain to you. Your hopes are dashed, your dreams are shattered like a castle in the sand, like a candle in the wind. There are so many questions, my friend, but there are no answers. So many problems, but there seems to be no solution. One day you are up and the next moment you are down. One moment you are laughing and the next moment you are crying. One moment you are on top of the world looking down on creation. One moment you have a great job and the next moment you are in employment. One moment you have life and the next moment there is death. One moment you have life and the next moment you have sickness. One moment you are married and the next moment you are in divorce course. But my friends, this morning, let me tell you that Christianity does not exempt us from life. Life will happen to you. Life will happen to you, my friends. Somebody this morning might be experiencing life. Oh, this morning, it took you a whole lot just to make it. Although you were home, it took you a whole lot this morning just to be on that Zoom platform. My friends, I want to ask you a question this morning. What do you do when your support system is removed from under you? What do you do when everything that you have banked on, everything you knew, is now blurred and obscured, everything you depended upon is now gone? What do you do? My believers and friends, this morning, hopelessness is a disease of the human spirit that is desperately hard to cure. Oh, this morning, my friends, although we serve God, we will be subjected to dealing with some heartbreak experience. Is there somebody this morning who is dealing with a heartbreak experience? Some of the saddest words in the English dictionary begins with the letter D. Disappointment, displeasure, discouragement, discontent, dissatisfied, doubt, disillusionment, distrust, disorder, distorted, distress, dismay, deserted, disconsolate, dejected, defeat, despair, depression, desolation, down, and even death. Am I describing somebody this morning? Oh, my friends, this morning, let me tell you, in every life, rain will fall. In every life, the wind will blow. Storms will rage. Trouble will come your way. There will be dark days. There will be cloudy days. Days of sorrow and pain. Days of sickness, my friend. And yes, even though you follow the 8 laws of health, my friend, sickness will come. And my friend, this morning, if we do not know Jesus in these days we are living, my friends, the devil will rock your boat this morning. You see, human hope is fragile. Like glass, it can break easily. Like a vapor, it can vanish away. It takes only one situation, my friends, to put you on a spiral motion. To you in Dominica, there was Erica, and while before you could breathe, here came Maria. And before you could even breathe, my friend, here came COVID. Oh, Dominica has gotten its share of the burden. Erica, Maria, COVID, my friend. But this morning, you are still here praising God. Oh, hallelujah. One sickness, my friend, can bring you down to your knees. Whoever thought that this world would be in total lockdown? One divorce, one breakup, one loss of paycheck, one freak accident. Oh, this morning you can encounter some situation that will shake you to your core, that will knock your boots right off your feet, my friend, that will cause you sometimes even to question your faith, will shake your very foundation. So my encouragement to you this morning, to you in the Eastern District and in the Southeastern District, and my Mount Moriah believers, my encouragement, my friend, is that if you don't know Jesus, you better find him now, because troubles sometimes are here, filling men's heart with fear. And our only safety net this morning is the man called Christ Jesus. When the rubber meets the road, when your back is against the wall, when the roof is caving in on you, who do you run to? Where do I go when there's nobody else to turn to? Who do I talk to when nobody wants to listen? Who do I lean on when there's no foundation stable? And the earth all around me is sinking sand, but this morning on Christ, the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, my foe, I can go to the rock. Where do I go? Where do I go when the storms of life are threatening? Who do I turn to when those winds of storms blow? And there is a refuge in the time of trouble. Or the song says, I go to the rock. I know he's able. I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders reject. I run to the mountain, my friend, and the mountain stands by me. This morning, we are happy, and that's the difference, my friend. There is a Jesus that we can run to. Ain't you happy this morning for Jesus? And you happy this morning for Jesus? Church, this morning the Lord wants us to know that he's getting ready to bring us into a season of greater, a season of better, a season of brighter. But the way that we can maximize our time in 2021 is by embracing the reality that this is a season. This is a season of beginning, and this is a season of endings. We have to understand this morning that even in our own walk with God, that it is impossible to start with God until we come to the end of ourselves. And the Bodwell sister sang it so right. They said, oh, kill my flesh and break my desire, and let me run after or thirst after your righteousness. Church, in order to press on, you must put your past in perspective, number one, first of all, by pushing past peculiar people. But I wanted to focus on the second P. Oh, you press on and put the past in perspective by not only pushing past some peculiar and particular people, but my friends, you have to, in order to press, my friends, you gotta go push past a past record. I'll say that again. You have to push past a past record. Paul tells us this morning, forgetting what is behind. Church, you must put your past into perspective. Too many people this morning are living in the past, holding on to the past. The person has left you and has been married and they have moved on, my friend. But it seems that you cannot let go. This morning, my word to you is let go. Person has been dead for years, Pastor. But you are still talking about what they did to you 30 years ago. I remember meeting a lady. She told me, Pastor, I'm never coming back to church again. And I said, well, why are you never coming back to church again? And she began to tell me all the wrong things that the elder had done to her. And I says, well, where is the elder? And she told me that the elder is dead. And I said, well, how long has the elder been dead? And she told me, the elder has been dead 20 long years, my friend. But she had not come to church in 20 years, my friend, because she was still holding on to grudges. I don't know about your, I don't know about the East District, Southeastern District, my friend, but I've seen people holding on to grudges for years over a candy, over a mint, over a peppermint, my friend, just for years. My friend, this morning, let it go. Many people cannot move forward into the future because of their past. Cannot enjoy today and tomorrow because of yesterday. Cannot move forward with God because, like Job's wife, my friend, they are still looking back. But this morning, I want to encourage you to let go of your past because there is a future. Yeah, that the future is brighter than the past, and your tomorrow, my friends, will be better than your today. Oh, hallelujah! There is a brighter future for you in spite of the pandemic, my friend. Let go of the past and hold on to Jesus and look to a brighter future. Oh, let me tell you this morning that every mistake is in your past. And let me tell you, if God has forgiven you and if God has buried your past into the deepest ocean where it shall be remembered no more, my friend, why are you still holding on to it? Let it go. Oh, hallelujah. Let it go. Your failure is in your past, my friends. Your failure is in the past. And the best that you can do, my friend, is wave goodbye. Goodbye to your past. Look at your past in your rearview mirror. Kiss your past goodbye, my friend, and keep on stepping. Are you with me this morning? Am I talking to somebody this morning who is still holding on to your past? Oh, let it go. Let it go. Let it go. They lied on you. Let it go. They mistreated you. They mistreated you as a child. Let it go. They divorced you. Let it go. They messed up your credit. Let it go. You did not get the promotion. Let it go. Whatever you have experienced in the past, my friend, please let it go, my friend, because you are moving forward. Is there somebody today who wants to move forward? Can you write in the chat, I'm moving forward? Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yesterday's history, tomorrow is a mystery. Today is a gift from God, and that's why we call it the present. Life this morning can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forwards. Oh, we are products of our past, but we don't have to be prisoners of it. Let me say that again. We are products of our past, but we don't have to be prisoners of it. I found out this morning that one of the impediments of everyone's progress is the obstinate and inflexible, rigid and resolute unwillingness to let some things go. You just cannot let it go. Oh, why? Oh, this morning, I've come to encourage you that God's purposes are not limited to your past. What matters most, oh, my friends, to our future is that God can work with what is left of you. You see, Paul wasted a lot of time persecuting the church, but Christ met him and he had a strong stroke on the Damascus Road and his life was no longer the same. And though he wasted many years, but the Lord said, I can work with what is left of you. In his past, Moses was a fugitive from justice with a speech impediment, but God made him a freedom fighter. In his past, Gideon was a coward soldier, but God made him a courageous captain. In his past, oh, my friend, Jacob was a corrupt con artist, but God made him a patriarch of a nation. In his past, Saul was an indignant enemy of the gospel, but God made him a fluent, influential, effective preacher of the gospel. In the past, Ruth lost her family, but God worked with the rest of her and gave her a new family and gave her a new faith and gave her a brand new future. In the past, Rahab was a prostitute, but God worked with the rest of her life and made her a one-woman rescue mission. In his past, the prodigal son wasted his life with riotous living, but his father worked with the rest of his life and made him a quintessential case for a comeback. In their past, Matthew was a racketeer, Mark was timid, Peter was temperament. Joseph was, Thomas was a skeptic, Nicodemus was a beggar. But let me tell you, my friend, Jesus worked with the rest of their lives and made them power patron and proponents for his providence. Oh, this morning, is there somebody this morning in Dominica? Is there somebody here in the U.S. this morning? Is there somebody who can testify with me that when we were lost in our sins, my friend, John Newton voiced our sentiments in lyrical expression and said it was amazing grace, how sweet the song that saved the wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Oh, I was blind, but now I can see. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We have to let some things go. Are you with me this morning? Let it go. Yes, let it go, church. Some things will go away if we can learn how to walk away. You don't have to hold on to your past, my friends. You can envision this morning a future exceptional. But church, how do we get this accomplished? Let me tell you, and that is the focus of my message this morning. You must have purpose. Are you listening to me? Are you listening to me this morning? You must have purpose. Oh, my brethren in Warner, my brethren in the Kalinagov territory, my brethren in River Spirit this morning, what is your purpose? You must have a purpose that will help us continue pressing. I believe this morning that I can fly. I believe this morning that I can touch the sky. Oh, hallelujah. I once was classified as not being pastor material, but I believe this morning that God has a good sense of humor. You see, people judge you and they look at you from the outward appearance, but hallelujah, there's a God who looks at you on the inside and says, oh yes, my friend, you are my man. You are my man this morning. Oh, hallelujah. And that's why I feel like praising my God and worshiping my God, my friend, because when I was counted up, my friend, it was God and God alone. It was God and God alone that took me and turned me around and planted my feet on higher ground. And he called me and he appointed me and he anointed me, my friend, to speak the gospel of truth. Oh, hallelujah. Our God is mighty. And this morning, he has given you a purpose, but you have to fulfill that purpose. All things this morning, all things with God are possible. Can I get an amen this morning that all things with God are possible? Oh, we must have a purpose that will help us to continue pressing on. Oh, this morning, and I know that the pandemic, my friend, is taking a toll on everyone. Oh, but this morning, the pandemic has made us into a sick cycle of sick citizens and a steady segment of society that have absolutely no ambition, no zeal, no desire to press on whatsoever. Oh, these people, my friend, they have harnessed their hopes, they have given up, they have thrown in the towel, my friend, they have banned their beliefs, they have fouled their faith and prevented their progress and barred themselves from future blessings, all because, my friend, they don't have the gumption and desire to keep on pushing and keep on pressing on. You see, they don't believe that eyes have seen and ears have heard and I have entered into the hearts of men the things that God has gone to prepare for those he love him. You see, they don't believe this morning that since we are the sons and daughters of God, that it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Oh, this morning, they don't believe that God is able to do abundantly, oh God, exceedingly above those things we ask. Oh, they don't believe that God can prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemy. They don't believe that there is no weapon that is formed against you that shall prosper, and every tongue that rises up against you, my friend, that God will condemn. They don't believe that I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. Oh, but church, this morning, I'm sorry, but I don't belong to such a pitiful pack of passive personality, because I believe that I can fly. I believe that I can touch the sky. This morning, I believe that in spite of COVID, that God, I believe that we can reach something higher. We can go further. We can do better, and we can see what else, my friends, what God has for us to do. Oh, this morning, church, we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Oh, yes, oh God, amen. You came to church and you do not even know where your lunch is coming from, but you still believe that I can do all things this morning through Christ that strengthens me. Oh, these these people strive no more, they dream no more, they wish no more, they believe no more, they hold on no longer, they reach no higher, they try no better, oh, they want no more, they seek no more, they knock no more, they ask no more, they choose no more, they pray no more, they plan no more, they fast no more, they aspire no more, and they look for nothing more. Oh, you need not to be part of this pack of passive people, but this morning, church, you need purpose. You should have an invigorating desire to see what else God is going to show you. You should be wondering what else God is going to do with you. You should be wanting to know what else God is going to say to you. You should be wanting to go to the places that God is going to take you. Hallelujah. Amen. I have a witness this morning. Oh, this morning, I am satisfied. We've been saved and sanctified and Holy Ghost filled and water baptized. I am blessed and managing my stress, and I'm safe and sane and above the ground. But I've decided this morning, oh hallelujah, to keep on pressing, amen, to keep on pushing. Oh, the Lord has made a way out of nowhere. He's picked me up and he's turned me around and he's revived me and he still surprises me. But I've decided this morning to push a little further, and I'm pressing on because God has given me a purpose this morning. Oh, this morning, press along, saints, press along in God's own way. Oh, press along, saints, press along in God's own way. You see, persecution we must bear, and trials and crosses is on our way. For the hotter, oh hallelujah, for the hotter the battle is this morning, oh, the sweeter the victory. And this morning, there is victory in Jesus if you will keep on pushing and if you will keep on pressing.
Oh, and if amen, you amen.
Any further, church, you must move this morning into a positive future, but you must have a purpose. Paul says, I'm striving forward, I'm straining forward, I'm reaching, oh hallelujah, I'm reaching forward for what? I'm reaching forward for a prize. This I know, my friend, is my purpose. I am pressing, oh, the song says, I'm pressing on the upward way. You see, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I onward bound. Oh, Lord, plant my feet this morning on higher ground. Plant my feet this morning on higher ground. Oh, yes, oh, yes. Oh, yes, this morning. Yes, as we go through this pandemic, I have to practice social distancing, wash and sanitize my hands. I have to wear a mask and take my temperature. But that's just my precaution for my protection. I follow the briefing and listen to the expert for rules and procedure. But my friend, that's just my protocol. You see, personally, I'm the proud father of 3 daughters and 3 grandchildren. And I've tried to protect them and prepare them and pilot them and provide for them. But you see, that's not my purpose. That's just my parenting. You see, I'm happily married for 35 years to a beautiful soul sister, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health. But that's not my purpose. That's just my covenant partnership. I am the proud leader of a popular progressive congregation, but that's not my purpose. That's just my pastoring. I am called as a converted clergyman, and it behooves and it becomes my desire to render some divine inspired oratory from the holy desk every Sabbath. But church, that's not my purpose. That's just my profession. You see, since I have been saved, I look forward to a life of bliss in heaven, but that's not my purpose. That's just my eternal peace. So I don't care for bars and blends and booze and beers and drugs and thugs and gangs and gambling. But you see, that's not my purpose. That's just my preference. I believe this morning that the body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, and therefore it must be regarded and guarded deeply and dispensed from virus and disease. I believe that health conscious primes us and pushes us and prompts us to eat right, to rest right, to exercise, and to follow the 8 laws of health. Oh, but church, this morning, that's not my purpose. That's just my preventative medicine. Oh, I believe in doing all things decently and in order, step by step, carefully and cautiously. Oh, but hallelujah, this morning. That's not my purpose. That's just my procedure. I believe, oh God, that I'm multi-talented and I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me, but that's just my potential. I take my obstacles and make them into opportunity, but this morning, that's just my persistency. I am personal enough to keep personal things personal and to keep other people out of my business, but that's not my purpose. That's just my privacy. Oh, I feel this morning highly energetic, and I feel that I can fly, and I feel that I can touch the sky, but that's not my purpose. That's just my potency. Oh, it is not within me to be violent and vulgar, timid and talkative, but rather easygoing, amiable, pleasant, peaceful, planned, and pronounced. So, but that's not my purpose. That's just my personality. I'm humbled by the admiration of aspiring prodigies, and I'm cautious, careful, concerned, and committed not to mislead or misdirect or misrepresent them. Oh, but this morning, that is still not my purpose. That's just my paradigm. I've learned not to intentionally imitate another for fear of impeding my originality. But my friends, that's not my purpose. That's just my peculiarity. Oh, I am blood-bought, blood-washed, saved and sanctified. I believe of the Christian doctrine, but that's not my purpose. That's just my religious persuasion. Oh, there is a fire this morning that burns within my bosom that pushes me to pronounce hope for the hopeless and help for the helpless and salvation for the sinners, but that's not my purpose. That's just my passion. Oh, I believe this morning that when you do good, good will come back to you, but that's not my purpose. That's just my philosophy. Oh, I've been injured, offended, adversely affected by those who claim to be my friends. I've been lied upon, talked about, mistreated, but I've restored to forgive them. But that's not my purpose this morning. That's just my pardon. I'm invariably invoked divine assistance. I pray for mind and means, for wisdom and where at all, for safety, for serenity, for security, for success and sincere supplication. But that's not my purpose. That's just my prayer life. Oh, the Spirit of God is upon me, and you have anointed me this morning to preach the gospel, to preach the gospel to a dying world. But that's not my purpose. That's not the position that he has placed me in. Oh, I have grown from where I was last year and made many steps forward and not backward, but that's just my progress. I have learned to become more efficient and effective at what I do, my friend, but that's just my proficiency. I've climbed from one stage to the next, and my responsibility have increased, but that's just my promotion. Oh, this morning, my purpose, let me tell you, is to press on. My purpose this morning is to press forward. Oh, love, I got it. Joy, I got it. Peace, I got it. Faith, I got it. The Holy Ghost, I got it. But the Lord said, oh, my God, John, you got to keep on pushing. You got to keep on pressing on the upward way. Oh, new heights I'm gaining every day. Oh, my God, I've decided this morning to follow Jesus, and there is no turning back, no turning back. You see, to me, returning is not an option. You may see me looking like Johnny Walker on a bottle of scotch whiskey about to fall, but I'm holding on, for I know that the man who puts his hands to the plow and look at back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Oh, people tell me sometimes, oh, I'm leaving church because somebody did not tell me good morning, or somebody stepped on my toe. Let me tell you this morning, oh, I have good news for you, because as feeble as the church may look this morning, it is still the church of God, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, my friend. Oh, if no one wants to go, yet I will follow. Let me say that if you are not going to heaven, in fact, don't prevent me. Don't be a burden. Don't be a burden. Oh, because I'm struggling, but I'm pressing, because I know that every step with Jesus goes higher and goes higher. Every step, oh, every step goes higher and higher, because every step I take and every move I make and every single day day. And every time I pray, I know this morning that God is watching me. Oh, I'm down, but I'm pressing. I'm up, but I'm pressing. I'm almost to the ground, but I'm pressing. I'm limping, but I'm pressing forward. Bruised, battered, broke, but I'm pressing forward. Oh, I may be down, my friend, but I'm not out yet. Why? Because I am still pressing. Don't count me out yet. Don't misdiagnose my mess as a message that I am messed up, because this morning, oh, Pastor Honore is still pressing forward. I've been weeping all night, my friend, but I'm pressing because I know that joy is gonna come in the morning. Oh, well, I'm tired. Oh, is there somebody this morning? You are tired and so weary, but you said, but I must press along because I know that I will reap if I faint not. Oh, I'm in the battle for my life, for my family, for my children, for my job, but I'm still pressing on this morning because I know that the battle is not mine, but the battle is the Lord's. And my friend, if God be for you, hallelujah, who else can be against you? My back or your back may be against the wall and all seems to be over for me, but I'm pressing because I know that I am not the victim, but I'm the victor, because greater is he that is in me this morning than he that is in the world. Oh yes, when the enemy comes against you like a flood, listen to me, I'm still pressing because I know that the Spirit of God this morning will set up a standard. Oh, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death this morning? I will keep on pressing because I know that he's the rod and he's the staff that will comfort me. Oh, this morning, I am just like a duck, my friend. I'm gonna shake the water off my back, my friend, and just keep on going. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Sorry about my excitement, my friend, but I cannot talk about Jesus if I do not get excited. Oh, hallelujah. If you have to know my background, if you have to know about my poverty, my friend, you will understand this morning why Pastor Honore is so joyous when he talks about Jesus. Because everything I do, my friend, it has to be about Jesus. Oh, are you listening to me? You are up, you are down, and sometimes you may be even almost to the ground, but you have to keep on pressing because I know that God is able to keep me from falling and to present me faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Oh, this morning I'm praying. I've prayed for some things in 2021, and those prayers seems not to be answered. In fact, sometimes, I don't know about you, but sometimes it looks like God is on vacation, but I'm still pressing, my friend, because I know that he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that I ask and I think, according to the power that is within him. Oh, my friend, sometimes it is one problem after another. I mentioned to you in Dominica, it was Erica, then it was Maria, then it was COVID, my friend. It seemed that when it rains for some people, it pours, but I'm not giving up. I'm pressing because I know, my friends, let me tell you that every problem has an expiration date. Are you listening to me this morning? Every problem has an expiration date. And the problem that you are going through, my friend, the date is about to be expired.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
There'll be mountains that I have to climb, and there'll be valleys. Anybody this morning climbing a mountain? Anybody climbing a valley? I will have to fight, but listen to me. But victory or defeat, listen to me, it's up to me to decide. But how can I expect to win? Hallelujah. If I never try. Is anybody going to say, I just can't give up now? Why? Because I've come too far from where I started. You see, nobody told me that the road would be easy. And I don't believe that he's brought me this far. Just to leave me. It seems like I'm at the end of my rope. But I'm pressing this morning because I know that every rope has an end.
Amen.
I never thought that I would have made it in 2020, but I'm pressing because listen to me, 2020 is now in my rearview mirror and I see bigger and better in 2021. Or to somebody morning, you might be in the pit this morning, but keep on pressing towards the valley. You might be in the dungeon, keep on pressing to your dream. You might be in the valley this morning, keep on pressing towards your victory. This is my story and it's not a good one this morning, but I'm pressing because I know that there is a song. I have sinned, but I'm pressing because I see salvation. Oh, sometimes I feel like garbage, but I'm pressing because I know that his grace is sufficient for me, my friend. I might be going to hell, but I'm pressing because I see heaven in view. The road is rough, my friends, and the going gets tough, and the hill sometimes, oh hallelujah, seems hard to climb. But I started out a long time ago. And you know what? I've made up my mind. And I've decided what? To make Jesus my choice. You see, returning for me is not an option. Paul says in Romans, who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? And if Paul was here today, he would say COVID-19 or coronavirus or this pandemic, will it separate us? Paul answers his own question. He says, no. In all these things, he say what? We are more than conquerors through him that loved us. He says, I'm persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of Christ. Christ Jesus. Keep on pressing because if you press and faint not, you will eat the fruit of the land. While you wait, press for they that wait on the Lord shall renew the strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Oh, this morning to you in the Eastern District, to you in the Southern District, to you at Mount Moriah, to those of you viewing, my friends, listen to me this morning. God have sent me to induce labor. You have dilated a few centimeters. But this morning I want you to push. Your water bag is already broken. But this morning, I want you to push.
Amen, amen.
Sometimes I'm up. I want you to push. Sometimes you are down. I want you to push. Sometimes the bills are due and your health is telling you. I want you to push. Your kids are acting up. You are unemployed. Your marriage is on the rock, my friend. But I want you to push.
Amen. Push.
God, this morning, will give you the strength to run the race. He'll give you the strength to fight a good fight of faith. He'll give you the fight to fight the battle. He'll give you the faith to climb the mountains, cross the valley, sail the stormy seas, to hold on, to battle cancer, to battle high blood pressure, to raise the skiffs, to finish the course. Oh, this morning, God will give you the strength to go to work on Monday and face a whole lot of demons, to make it through this trial, to withstand the turbulence. He'll give you assurance for your issues, survive this storm, overcome obstacles, to hold your peace and let the Lord fight your battle. Oh, my brethren, this morning, he can help you bear your burden, meet every demand, attain any goal, weather any storm, kick any habit, handle any loss, win any battle, conquer any foe, bear any pain, carry any load, outlast any problem. Oh, this morning, God can help you overcome any obstacle, defeat any demon, deal with any dilemma, resist any temptation, pass any test, survive any trial, make you a champion in spite of your challenges, give you a crown in spite of your cross, give you victory, although you are in the valley. He will turn your test into a testimony, your mess into a message. Oh, he will give you a song for your story. Oh, this morning, God will help you to pray through your problem, withstand any strain, face any opposition, quit any habit, worship to any strife, dance to any difficulty, praise to any problem, shout through any struggle, sing through your storm. Oh, hallelujah. He'll help you this morning. Rest when it's rough. He will help you push when it's tough. He will help you to hold on when it's hard. He'll help you to shine when it's dark. He will help you this morning to stand when you are fallen and you can get up. Oh, this morning as I close, let me close with this and tell you, oh, if you are in self-quarantine and isolation because of COVID-19, oh, this morning God can proximate If fear have taken over you, have overtaken you, he knows how to pacificate. If you are sick, he knows how to medicate. If you are hungry, he knows how to saturate. If you are down, he knows how to elevate. If you're in darkness, he knows how to illuminate. If you are broke, he knows how to calculate. If you are lonely, he can be intimate. He can be intimate. If you are neglected, oh, my friend, he can become your associate. If you are ignored, he is affectionate. When I don't have enough, he's adding. Equate. When your bank account is in the negative, he equates. When you are lost, he navigates. When you have gone astray, he reinstates. When you are sick, he tolerates. When you are in sin, he tolerates. When you are empty, he inundates. When you are disorganized, he administrates. When you need a lawyer, he advocates. Before I call, he anticipates. When you are in trouble, he can be immediate. When you are thirsty, he hydrates. When you are barren, he impregnates. When you have lost your zeal, he's passionate. When you cannot sleep, he caffeinates. When I'm stressed out and my blood pressure is skyrocketing, he regulates. When I have nothing, he creates. When I need a cure for COVID-19, he vaccinates. When I am assertive, he predicates. When I don't know, he demonstrates. When I don't understand, he assimilates. When I cannot talk, he communicates. When I'm ill, he operates. When I'm bored, he fascinates. When I need a boost, he rejuvenates. When I am in danger, he isolates. When my enemies attack, he eliminates. When the devil surrounds me, he obliterates. When I'm disorganized, he coordinates. When I need a word, he summons. When I'm sad, he jubilates. When I'm good, he appreciates. When I'm trumped out, he subjugates. When I pass a test, he congratulates. When it seems like my prayers are not answered and the wait is too long, my friend, oh, hallelujah, this morning, my God is never, never, never late. Oh, this morning, I want to talk to somebody. Amen. This morning, before the person comes to pray, this morning, you are discouraged. This morning, it seems like, oh my God, I cannot make it. Life is too hard. Pastor Henry, I don't know your district, but somebody lost their job. Somebody is asking for a bailout. Somebody is hurting. Somebody's marriage is on the rocks. Somebody's children who was raised in church is now out there. And you are saying, my friends, I'm about to give up. Listen to me this morning. That's why God sent me here. I came to talk to somebody who's about to give up. You're saying, I'm at my wit's end. And God, if you don't come today, if you don't come to my rescue, I'll be lost. Is there somebody this morning who says, pray for me this morning? You want to go to the chat and you just want to go to the bottom on the reaction and just raise your hand. Somebody's going to come to pray. But you want to say, pray for me this morning, Pastor. You want to say, this morning, I got a word of faith. I got a word of faith this morning. I got a word of encouragement to keep me going. This morning, I want you to keep on pressing. Don't give up. Don't give up on God. Don't quit on God. Don't fire God. Don't terminate God out of your life. Because this morning, God is able. God is able this morning to open your Red Sea and let you walk on dry ground. This morning, God is able to cool your fiery furnace and let no harm come to you. This morning, God is able to tell you, go catch a fish, open its stomach, and there you're gonna find money to pay your bills. What a God we serve. What a mighty God. Pastor, I'm not sure if your church is conservative, so if I shouted too much or I jumped out too much, I apologize, my friend, but I cannot talk about my God if I do not get excited.
That's what we like, Pastor. That's what we like. Amen.
And my church at Mount Moriah, we are a church that praises God because we know what God can do.
That's right. That's what we like.
Sorry about my excitement, my friend. But this morning, my God is able.
Amen.
And he wants to work it out for you. Somebody today, you're saying, Pastor, I'm at my wife's hand. I'm about to give up. It's almost the first of the month. I think the first of the month is on Wednesday, and I don't see where the rent is coming from. But God is telling you this morning, lean on me, trust me, hold on to my hands, and don't let go. All eyes are closed, all eyes are bowed. Pastor, I think that there's somebody who is assigned to pray.
All right, Brother Nathaniel, you could go ahead and, Brother Dura.
I'm here, Pastor.
All right.
In that case, we want to thank the brother, the pastor, for this stirring message. And I'd like to now invite all of us to do our closing song, song number 518, My Faith Looks Up to Thee, Thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior Divine. Oh, hear me while I pray, take all my sins away. Oh, let me from this day be wholly thine. So you can join me from wherever you are to sing this beautiful song. My faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Oh, hear me while I pray, take all my sin guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be holy thine. May thy rich grace impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire. As thou hast died for me, oh, may my love to thee, pure, warm, and changeless, be a living fire. While life's dark maze I tread, and griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. Be darkness turn to day, while sorrows tears away. No, let me ever stray from thee.
Amen.
Oh my God, we pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day of rest. This portion of our lives that we give back to you because you have given us so much. We thank you for life. As we thank you for this day of rest, and as we've come in fellowship, even through this medium, we want to thank you for the opportunity. We want to thank you for this blessing. And we want to thank you for the blessings that you have in store for all those who will worship you, because you are God and you are God alone. We see you as our creator and our God. The same way you see your children, you see every need, you see every face, though they differ from wherever part of the world that they are. But you know, in our hearts, each and every one, there is one longing to do your will and to do it with you every step of the way, that when thou comest again, we may be found worthy and not wanting, blessed to enter and share in your eternal kingdom. We pray that you'll continue to guide and bless each and everyone. Hear us as we pray. Take our sins away, and may from this day that we be wholly thine, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Honore. Man, there are so many words that we can use this morning to describe what transpired here. But only one word comes to my mind at this time. It is the Holy Spirit. You will move by the Holy Spirit this morning, this afternoon. And we want to thank God. We want to thank God for using you in such a mighty way. We were blessed. And so, man, I can sense that Dominican flavor, that Dominican heat, you know, that Dominican fire in your body. And so, brother, elder, pastor, honoree, thank you so much for the word this morning. I know, and I know you're wondering if my church is conservative. You know, just check the chat. All right, check the YouTube chat, and you will get your answer. All right, and let me ask the members to just open up your mic, and whoever you are, and you wanna tell Pastor, you know, honoree, thank you for the word this morning. You know, just unmute your mic and go ahead and thank Pastor honoree for the word this morning. Whoever you are, just go thank Pastor honoree for the word this morning. Just unmute your mic and go ahead.
Because Pastor Monique, I just thank you for greeting us with your presence. Indeed, I've been blessed, and we're not the conservative type. That's my kind of preaching.
That's
thank you, Pastor.
Yes, thank you, young man.
It was a powerful preaching.
Thank you, young man.
yes.
I was truly blessed. Indeed, there are some mistakes because by listening to your word, I really put it to practice. And I say thank you very much, and you're most welcome.
Amen. As my auntie, by the way, press on, Auntie Jane. All right.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath, Sister Hall.
Hi. I'm just saying thank you to my pastor, the world's greatest pastor, and he really inspired me this morning. Thank you so much.
Sister Rachel, we're going to take him, you know.
No, please don't. Please don't. You're a blessing, Pastor. Thank you so much.
Thank you
for your message and the words. Thank you.
Pastor,
God bless you.
Pastor, I just want to thank you for the word. And I believe if anyone entered this chat feeling down, depressed, discouraged, they were left feeling blessed. I want to thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Sister Henry. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Pastor, the message was just for me today, and I thank God for using the Holy Spirit to speak through you.
Praise God. Amen.
Sister Henry, I think my grandmother's trying to get a word in. Go ahead.
I am blessed. I am blessed. Thank you for this wonderful message. And I pray to God that you will come again. And
you must come back. You must come back.
Praise God. God bless you and your family.
Praise God. Give God the praise.
Pastor Honore, welcome to Poetica. Enjoy the sermon.
All right. Praise God.
You were there in your absence. We need you in your presence, eh?
Praise God, Father. Praise God.
We need you in the flesh.
Praise God.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yes. Thank you. For the bell. Praise God.
Thank you. Praise God. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath to you.
It was nice having you. I'm Maggie, all the way from St. Martin.
That's my auntie
from Ephesus Church. Pastor John.
Ephesus, and my brother's an elder Ephesus.
Yes. Just send a shout out to my nephew, Pastor Henry, my mom, Don Henry, and my sister Jane Henry, and to everyone else, happy Sabbath.
And this is
family. Our regards, brother Evans, for the Evans, and
okay.
All right, and this is the good to have you.
Sorry that you can't see me, but my camera is not working, but I can see everybody.
All right, man. You need to upgrade your camera, auntie. All right.
Amen. So Pastor, we'll join you guys. My AY leader said that we'll join you guys for AY.
Right. So yes. we will send the link to you so that you can circulate it among your membership. All right, Pastor.
No problem. Thanks again for the opportunity.
All right, members of Mount Moriah, thank you for being here with us. God bless you.
God bless everyone.
All right. See you. This
okay. Afternoon. Take care.
Uh-huh. All right. Yes.
I saw any presents ever.
All right, it's a flavorful flavor.
All right.
All right, sis.
You don't talk, she'd have an ointment on if it doesn't matter.
Elder Bonnet, good to have you. Good to have you here this morning, man.
he's away from the camera now. So.
Oh, okay, Sister Bonnet. I'm happy that you were able to join today. All right.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. All right.
Yeah, and I don't know if Flavia is still on the line. Flavia, it's good to hear you. It's been a long time. I'm glad to know you're keeping well.
Hey.
And everybody else. Yes, ma'am.
How are you?
I'm wonderful. Thank you. And I hope you're keeping well as well.
Welcome to have see you back.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Brother David Mann, good to have you.
Hi, Granny.
Hi, Pastor. Osias.
Hi, Pastor Tony. Pastor.
How are you, my boy? You good?
Yes, I'm good.
Tell Mommy, send you down and meet me.
Okay.
All right.
Have a good day.
Thank you. You too. Bye-bye. See you this afternoon.
Yes.
All right. Sister Janet, I hope your hand is much better.
Yes, Pastor.
Right, okay.
Pleasant right. Sabbath to all.
Thank you.
Pleasant Sabbath, Sister Janet.
All right.
Pleasant Sabbath, and I hope to see everybody this afternoon.
All right. Thank you, Sister Bully, for the Sabbath school. You always do a good job. Always do a good job.
God be praised, Pastor. God be praised.
Yeah.